Really a blessing to be here explaining how the Dioprox method has been incorporated in the church and why it is that the church is doing this. Unfortunately, nowadays many churches have become temples of doom. I'll be your guide. Francis Schaeffer said, in a post-Christian world and in often a post-Christian church, it is imperative to point out with love where apostasy lies. We must call apostasy by its proper name, and this indeed, what I'm presenting, is apostasy. Ephesians 5:11, we're to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. And 2 Corinthians 2, we're told that lest Satan should get an advantage of us, we are not to be ignorant of his devices. So I'm going to try to help you not be ignorant of Satan's devices as they have infiltrated the church. Well, it's based upon the Hegelian dialectic, George Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel, from 1770 to 1831, popularized this. What the Dioprox is the repeated practice or praxis of the Hegelian dialectic in order to achieve gradual incremental change, also known as innovation. The Hegelian dialectic is based on thesis plus antithesis leading to synthesis. In other words, an opposite, two opposites, when molded together, create a new synthesis. Now, when you have the new synthesis, that becomes your starting point for the next round. And so, as you're mixing truth and untruth together, each time you repeat this process, you're going a little bit further away from the truth. If you think of mixing paints, if you start with white paint, you add a little bit of black paint. The first time around, it's a little bit gray. You add a little bit more black paint, and it's a lot more gray, and eventually it ends up black. So that's what is happening here. It's a gradual process, but it takes you far from where you began. The Dioprox, then, is a diverse group of people. In church growth, it's believers being mixed in with unbelievers, thesis and antithesis, gathering together repeatedly over a social issue in a seeker-sensitive church service, Bible studies, supposedly, or small groups. These meetings are facilitated. The facilitator is also known as a change agent or a group leader, and they're achieving consensus, which is the predetermined outcome. When you mix believers and unbelievers and you achieve consensus, you have achieved the outcome which these people want, which is taking the believer away from his original statement of faith and his original basis on the Bible. Peter F. Drucker, who's very important in this process, says that open discussion uncovers what the objections or antitheses are. With genuine participation, a decision doesn't need to be sold. Suggestions can be incorporated, objections addressed or ignored, basically. And the decision itself, consensus, becomes a commitment to action. So dissent, he says, is a necessary ingredient for innovation or change and commitment. Without dissent, antithesis, you can't enter into the dialectic process. That's why there is such an emphasis in this church growth movement of bringing unbelievers in. You have to bring the dissenting opinion into the church to move people away from their original basis in fact. With each cycle of this change process, the believer is moved ever so slightly away from his or her original position of moral absolutism in order to continue to get along with the group and achieve human relationship. Conflict, chaos, or tension is a necessary ingredient. The group becomes willing to compromise and achieve consensus in order to resolve the conflict because the conflict is uncomfortable. So you agree to disagree, and then you can resolve the conflict. This out of Willow Creek, which is tied to Saddleback Church. Willow Creek has this book, Building a Church of Small Groups. They say allow the group to live in the tension of unresolved conflict. They deliberately bring in this tension so they can move the group. We kind of learned this with Get Smart back in the 1960s. We had control were the good guys, chaos were the bad guys, and we all got smart when we rooted for control. But God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. So we're not supposed to be deliberately bringing unresolved conflict into our small groups in the churches. This is not from God. This is satanic literature from Alice Bailey and Joal Cool, which was a channeled spirit that Alice Bailey channeled. The statement is unity becomes possible and the point of balance through attainment of a point of tension. Again, you have to bring in this unresolved conflict first and then move people away from it. Building a church of small groups again. The point of navigating conflict is to restore relationships we value. We want to reach consensus and move forward. Sometimes that may mean agreeing to disagree or deciding to overlook an offense for the sake of relationship. So we deliberately bring in conflict into the group, and the reason is so we can resolve it and bond together. Purpose-driven life says, nod that you understand even when you don't agree. So you look at the group and you say, I don't agree with you. That's called lying. Well, change technology. This is a very interesting book. They really admit it right here. They say you have to break through the brain barrier in order to go through change technology. The brain is a barrier to change, so turn your brain off and then you can change. Well, peer pressure or belonging is the force that is utilized by the agents of change to achieve their purposes. Consensus is also compromise, and so I would say that to repeatedly practice consensus building is to learn the habit of compromise. The abortion debate is a perfect example of how this process works. The first step is to challenge what is. Is it really life at conception? Let's challenge that. And we'll say, okay, maybe it isn't because it's a bundle of cells that doesn't feel anything, doesn't know anything, doesn't realize it exists. So we can challenge that. Maybe it's not really life then, okay? Then we incrementally move away from that through the process of continual change. And we get the Supreme Court to agree that if it's an unfeeling bundle of cells that doesn't even know it exists, that we can destroy it at that point in time. And then we can push it through maybe a couple weeks after conception, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, first trimester, second trimester, and we end up with partial birth abortion. Well, Jay Kesner-Kahn said it's better we disagree than be in agreement and all be wrong. And believe me, when society believes that this is acceptable, society is wrong. I firmly believe that the Supreme Court would not have ruled on Roe v. Wade if they were told at the front end of things that that was where it was going to lead. So that's what this change process does. They get you on the slippery slope and they gradually take you away to do unthinkable things which you would have never thought of doing in the first place. And you wouldn't have ever accepted it in the first place. Hegelian dialectic, dictionary of philosophy, says it's a developmental and evolutionary in character, and its end point is complete perfection. In other words, they believe this is evolution, and if we use this Hegelian dialectic process, we can achieve perfection or become God, okay? That's what it is thinking that we can achieve God and we can achieve heaven apart from God. Well, on the small scale, this dialectic process leads to group harmony. On the large scale, they believe it's going to lead to religious harmony and world harmony. And this group, the International Correspondence League, believes the process will lead to world peace. Well, the definition of church growth movement, I have my own definition, which I will show you in a little bit, and I've been criticized for not giving the official definition. So here's the official definition from the American Society for Church Growth. They call it a discipline which investigates the nature, expansion, planting, multiplication, function, and health of Christian churches as they relate to the effective implementation of Christ's commission to make disciples of all peoples. Church growth advocates strive to integrate the eternal theological principles of God's Word concerning the expansion of the church with the best insights of contemporary social and behavioral sciences, employing as the initial frame of reference the foundational work done by Donald McGavran. So we're going to integrate the eternal theological principles of God's Word along with the satanic social and behavioral scientists who are godless, and we're going to mix that together, and that's going to be church growth. That's their definition, okay? Well, who is this McGavran that they're basing it on? Well, he says that peoples become Christian as a wave of decision for Christ sweeps through the group mind, involving many individual decisions, but being far more than merely their sum. This might be called a chain reaction. So peoples become Christian as groups rather than it being an individual event. Each decision sets off others, and the sum total powerfully affects every individual. When conditions are right, not merely each subgroup, but the entire group concerned decides together. Well, this is my definition. I say it's the utilization of modern marketing techniques by the church in order to draw and hold large numbers of people by meeting their felt needs. The church then, quote, converts them and, quote, disciples them through the use of modern organizational management or total quality management style techniques so that they can affect change in the community and the world. 2 Corinthians, but I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. You will see how complex this church growth process is and what they want you to get involved in. And the bottom line is, the Word of God is very simple, okay? We're sinful and we're depraved and we need a Savior. And once we bow our knee to Him, then He will save us. It's very simple. We're not to be conformed to this world. We're to be transformed by the renewing of our mind that we may prove that what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. This is the true transformation that should take place, is the transformation by the Holy Spirit of our minds, not the transformation by the transformational Marxist through group mind techniques and manipulations. Well, who's one of the main people of church growth? Dr. Rick Warren founded Saddleback Church. They call this a cue ball church because this and Willow Creek are the two main cue ball churches, and they hit all the other balls and they spread this disease throughout the rest of the country. He's part of the Southern Baptist Convention. He authored Purpose Driven Church and Purpose Driven Life with over 1 million and 11 million copies sold respectively. He's trained over 300,000 pastors and leaders in church growth principles. He has a doctorate from Fuller Theological Seminary. Rick Warren says that pastors are probably the most underrated group of change agents today. Change agents, these are facilitators, these are the manipulators, these are the people who are manipulating the group to do their dirty work. Saddleback Church just celebrated 25 years of changing lives together, okay? This isn't Jesus Christ changing lives and the Holy Spirit renewing and transforming your mind. We're changing you in the group. The deception of change technology. The Change Agents Handbook admits that at any point in time, the management team only needs to know enough to take the next step towards achieving its goals. So in other words, just like the abortion debate, we're not going to tell you what the end play is. We're just going to tell you to take the next step, and you're supposed to have faith in us that we're going to take you the right direction. Well, Proverbs warns us against change technology. It says, my son, fear the Lord and the king, and meddle not with them that are given to change. For their calamity shall rise suddenly, and who knows the ruin of them both. Purpose-driven church, growth without compromising your message and mission. This is not Christ's message. This is your message. Church growth is also known as seeker sensitivity, user-friendliness, purpose-driven, mission-driven, cell churches, meta-churches, disciple-making churches, and churches of the 21st century. They keep changing the names to protect the guilty. If you say, you're a purpose-driven church, oh, no, we're not, we're a cell church. They just will keep changing the names. Anyway, Christianity Today says that Rick Warren is a regular guy who may just be America's most influential pastor. He's not a regular guy, and as far as I'm concerned, he's not a pastor either. He comes up with purpose-driven life, but it's interesting because he has the patent on that term, and he allowed Anthony Robbins, a New Ager, to, down here at the bottom, it says how to create a purpose-driven life before Purpose-Driven Life book came out. Purpose-driven life says hope comes from having a purpose. Your purpose becomes the standard you use to evaluate which activities are essential and which aren't. He has substituted the word purpose for God. And if you read that book, and because hope comes from having God, not hope from comes from having purpose, and God is the standard we're supposed to be using to evaluate which activities are essential in our lives and which are not. So purpose has replaced God. He says the greatest tragedy is not death, but life without purpose. No, the greatest tragedy is life without God. He wants you to enjoy life, not just endure it. The reason you are able to enjoy pleasure is that God made you in His image. No, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says we're depraved. The Bible says that pleasure is fleshly lust. He doesn't want us to enjoy fleshly lust. He wants us to bow to Him. The Word of God says all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. This isn't all about us having pleasure in this life. It's all about us living godly in Christ Jesus. Purpose-driven life is endorsed by Billy Graham, Franklin Graham, Bruce Wilkinson, Max Lucado. Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. So when your book hits the New York Times bestseller list for 40 weeks in a row, watch out. The world is rewarding you and applauding you. You must not be standing for God. Similarly, we saw it recently when this gentleman killed the people in the courtroom in Georgia and then ended up in this woman's apartment, and she said that she got out her Bible and purpose-driven life. And then you heard nothing actually more about the Bible after that. All they talked about was purpose-driven life. And she was on Larry King Live and all these wonderful things, everybody acclaiming purpose-driven life and nobody talking about the Bible anymore. And she gave the man the wrong message. She gave the man the message that maybe God has a plan for you and you're supposed to go to jail and preach in jail. No, the message is you're a depraved sinner and you need to repent. And if you don't repent, you're not going to be saved. So she gave the wrong message. She gave the purpose-driven message. Well, the purpose-driven life is merely a rewrite of this book, Total Life Management, which is total quality management for your life. It's all about making your mission statement and your vision statement and plotting out your plan for your life. You know, we're not even to think about tomorrow. The Bible tells us don't even give thought for tomorrow. Sufficient is evil for today, for this day. And so when you set a goal for yourself for 20 years from now, and that's going to be my goal for 20 years, okay, even God can't deviate you away from that. Where if you're open to the leading of the Holy Spirit, He's going to move you in different directions in your life. You had absolutely no idea where He was going to take you to. You can't set this goal and shoot for the goal and measure the goal and evaluate the measurements and keep going for that same goal. You just can't do it. It's not from God. He doesn't do it that way. Pastor Rick Warren says that Tom Patterson was one of the three strongest pillars, along with Peter Drucker and Bob Buford, of our purpose-driven church strategy in the formative years of Saddleback Church. He founded his church on men. Okay? Other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. The church is supposed to be founded on the rock of Jesus Christ, not on Tom Patterson, not on Peter Drucker, and not on Bob Buford. And I'm going to tell you a lot about Drucker and Buford, and you're going to see that shifting sand.
What I love about Peter Drucker is that he helps those of us in nonprofit ministries to figure out what is the purpose. He emphasizes, why are you here? If you don't know why you're there, then you have no reason to exist.
Loves Peter Drucker. Who is Peter Drucker? Drucker was born in Vienna, Austria in 1909. He's still with us. He shaped and directed the Leadership Network since its inception. He previously was a professor at NYU. He's currently at Claremont Graduate School in Southern California. Drucker states that social disciplines such as management deal with the behavior of people and human institutions. The social universe has no natural laws such as the physical sciences do. It is thus subject to continuous change. This means that assumptions which were valid yesterday can become invalid and indeed totally misleading in no time at all. In other words, he believes that there are no moral absolutes. Okay? He believes that there are laws of physics, but he doesn't believe that there are laws of right and wrong, which are eternally true. That statement sounds very much like this statement. In the eyes of dialectical philosophy, nothing is established for all times. Nothing is absolute or sacred. That's Karl Marx. Ken Blanchard, who has been working with Rick Warren on his Lead Like Jesus, says, after studying both the theory and practice of leadership for more than 35 years, I have found that Jesus is the greatest leadership model of all time. Theory and practice, Marxist terms. Ken Blanchard, out of the National Training Laboratories, a New Ager. Rick Warren has been contradicting himself tremendously because he's been called on it by this Lighthouse Trails project. And they emailed Warren and said, you know, you're getting involved with this New Ager, and he's been endorsing all of these people. Rick Warren then fires back and says, well, he's a brand new believer. He's a baby believer. Well, number one, Blanchard has never repented of any of those New Age dealings. Number two, he claims to have been a Christian for over 20 years, and Rick Warren's saying he's a new believer. Now, if he really is a new believer, then Rick Warren shouldn't be putting him into leadership positions because it says lay hands on no man rapidly. Okay, so Rick is caught up in a whole mess of lies right now and proving that it's just not from God. Anyway, Christianity Today says that Peter Drucker is a Christian, a practicing Episcopalian, but from his writings it would be hard to say much more than that about his faith. Drucker's writings seem determined to keep his faith a secondary characteristic for his readers. So in other words, Drucker's ashamed to be a Christian, if he claims to be a Christian, but he's not a Christian. Drucker says every one of his books and essays, whether dealing with politics, philosophy, or history, or with social order and social institutions, management, technology, or economics, has stressed pluralism and diversity. That is not a Christian concept. Okay, we do not serve a pluralistic God. We believe there is one God, and we can't accept all of these other diverse arguments. He calls Rick Warren the inventor of perpetual revival. In other words, he's the one who brought the process of continual change into the church. Jesus said his church is not to be made a house of merchandise. This is business and management. This is merchandising the people of God. The first part of the definition, again, the utilization of modern marketing techniques or merchandising techniques by the church in order to draw and hold large numbers of people by meeting their felt needs. Pastors that doing this, Rick Warren, Bill Hybels, they are both built on Robert Schuller. This is another lie that Rick Warren's getting caught up in, is his ties to Schuller. He's recently emailing that he's never personally met Schuller. Interesting, because Schuller in his book says that Warren and Hybels are students who outran their teacher. And there's also another article in Christianity Today where it talks about Kay Warren and Rick Warren meeting with Schuller, and then Kay, Rick Warren's wife, said that we were changed after that, and we've never been the same since. So again, he's getting caught up in all kinds of lies as he's getting called on this. 2 Corinthians again, no marvel. Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it's no great thing if his ministers also are transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. Rick Warren's in dangerous ground here. Felt needs, all three of those, Schuller, Hybels, and Warren, built their churches based on surveys of their communities by determining the felt needs and then tailoring their churches to meet those needs. The felt needs survey says if they were actively attending any church, Rick Warren said, I didn't bother asking the other three questions because I didn't want to cover the survey with believers' opinions. I wanted to give non-believers a place where they could feel comfortable. I didn't want to give believers a church. Peter Drucker says all great change in business has come from outside the firm, not from inside. This is why you're bringing unbelievers into the church, is to change the church, not for the better.
We minister to every kind of need, social need, spiritual need, economic need, material needs. We believe that if there's a need, that God meant for the church to meet that need. The people do not exist for the church. The church exists for the community.
Scripture whatsoever that says that the church is to meet the needs of the people and to meet the needs of the community. Peter Drucker, though, says business exists to meet human needs. Well, regarding felt needs, Paul talked about it. He said, not that I speak in respect of want, I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. So we as Christians are to be content with whatever the Lord has given us or not chosen not to give us. We're not to be running to the church to have them meet all of our needs. This is Rick Warren's target, a relatively successful man. He claims he was led by God to Mission Viejo, California, to build his church because it was the fastest growing and also the highest average income and with the least number of churches. And so God called him to go there to pastor his church. What is the church? Well, the Word of God says that He gave some apostles, some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. The church is for the building up of the believers, the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for edifying the body of Christ, edifying the saints, not edifying the community. And we're to come in the unity of the faith. This is not consensus. This is the unity of the faith, is that we are all agreeing that this is going to be the standard of our lives. Then you will have true koinonia and true fellowship with the people. This has got to be the first standard and the first goal. The relationship is the secondary outflowing from that, not the first goal being the relationship and putting the Word of God second. That's what this has done. It's turned it upside down. First impressions then in these churches, they have preferred parking for first-time visitors. I've been to Saddleback Church. They have you turn your lights on if you've never been there before, and then they direct you right to the front because they found out on their surveys that the first 8 minutes, you'll decide whether you're going to go back to that church or not. If you spend your first 8 minutes looking for a parking space and walking across the parking lot, you won't have a good experience the first time. You won't go back. So they put you right up in front. They have greeters like Walmart. They have unchurch-like setting with seats rather than pews, often a sanitized sanctuary with no religious symbols, crosses, stained glass windows, or Ten Commandments. Presentation is informal, usually with polo or aloha shirts, drama. They have a lot of distraction with video screens. The Rick Warren's church has 5 video screens, and the pastors have mobile microphones. They pace back and forth. And they have used a lot of contemporary music and dance affiliated with all of this. All of this is overwhelming the rest of your senses, and so you're turning off your mind as far as what the actual message that's being preached. Dr. Jack Wheaton has an excellent book on crisis in Christian music and why a lot of this rock and roll music and things are not really edifying for Christians. The message. Handouts are utilized. Bibles are rarely used. They have multiple Bible versions, and they discourage or condemn the use of the King James because it's got didactic teaching, fact-based teaching. They have watered-down, non-offensive messages. They avoid sin, depravity, repentance, judgment, or a literal burning hell. And self-esteem and felt needs are met. They're highly motivational speaking. And it's designed to make it more comfortable and easier to come to faith. Alpha Course is also based on the same notion that it's supposed to be more comfortable and easy to come to faith. And my argument is, having been through some of the Alpha Courses, that you never get there. Alpha has been endorsed by the late Bill Bright, Bob Buford, Tony Campolo, Christianity Today, Chuck Colson, Fuller Theological Seminary, Jack Hayford, Roberta Hestenes, an apostate female pastor, Louis Palau, Roman Catholic bishops, Robert Schuller, Trinity International University, the Navigators, C. Peter Wagner from Fuller Theological, Rick Warren, and Lake John Wimber. Well, Christ had something to say about seeker-sensitive messages. They asked him why he spoke in parables, and he answered and said, "Because it's given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. For whosoever has, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever has not, from him shall be taken away even that he hath. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because they seeing see not, and hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, By hearing you shall hear, and shall not understand, and seeing you shall see, and shall not perceive. This people's heart is waxed gross, their ears are dull of hearing, their eyes they have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their heart and should be converted and I should heal them." What he is saying is he was cloaking his message. This was not a seeker-sensitive message for everybody, bringing the cookies down to the bottom shelf, as J. Vernon McGee would say. These messages were cloaked in parables, so that the people who the Lord had opened their ears and opened their hearts to understand would understand it, and the other people would walk away scratching their head saying, "What was that all about?" Well, this is not a rare scripture that I picked out. It's actually quoted in Isaiah, all four Gospels and the book of Acts. So it's a very clear message that Jesus wasn't seeker sensitive. You know, when he said, "Woe unto you, you scribes and Pharisees and you den of vipers," and all of those things, that wasn't seeker sensitive. He wasn't trying to make everybody feel good. Well, the message is ambiguous. It sounds reasonable to traditional, transitional, and transformational thinkers. Now, what are those types of thinkers? A traditional thinker is a black and white thinker, right and wrong, yes and no, very, very didactic. Transitional is kind of in between and kind of sitting on the fence and can go either way. Transformational thinker can justify why it is they don't have to attend to the facts. And it doesn't matter how many facts you hit them with, it just bounces off and they just keep going on with their merry way. And we've all met people like that, and we try to share the gospel message with people like that, and their eyes glaze over and they get a blank stare and you know you're done. Traditional, the best way to describe how this process works, because it's these are a gradation here. People start out traditional. They start out with right and wrong. We can do it with the homosexual issue. We'll explain it well. Traditional thinker says a man is made for a woman, a woman's made for a man. That's it. End of story. The transitional person is somebody who's open to experimentation. And so they start thinking, well, maybe I'll try this, maybe I won't. And they may experiment some. And after a while, they may realize, no, that was insane. What was I doing? And they go back and they become traditional. But they could go forward and they could become transformational. And when they go transformational, they get all the way to the point where they say, aha, well, God made me this way and I can't change. And this is the way I'm supposed to be. And they can justify why it is they don't have to attend to the facts anymore. And it doesn't matter how many facts you hit them with, they just stay in rebellion. And there's no going back for those people. So that's the different types of thinkers. When you have an ambiguous message and you share half of a scripture, the traditional person who knows the Bible fills in the other half and says, gee, that sounded like a pretty good message, because they filled in the second half of the scripture. The transformational thinker justifies why they don't have to attend to the scripture, and when only half the scripture was presented anyway, they can actually walk away also being uplifted by the same message. And so the believer and the unbeliever can both go away happy with the same message. Charles Stanley's ministry was asked one time in one of their In Touch magazine, what should I do? My husband's not a believer, and I'm a believer. What should I do? And he says, go to a seeker-sensitive church, because that way you'll both be happy. Well, the message is full of half-truths. It's ambiguous, and they have subtle or subliminal messages. I've had a bend at Saddleback Church when Lee Strobel was talking, and he was talking about misguided nationalism being the cause of worldwide hunger. In other words, give up your sovereignties and everybody share, and then there won't be any hunger in the world, as opposed to corrupt governments being the cause, because we send food over to certain areas and the corrupt government sells it to somebody else rather than give it to their own people. So again, but what they're doing is, in the subliminal message there is, you know, forget your sovereignty and be willing to give it up. It's also combined again with distraction. When you've got all the video screens and people moving around and dancing and everything, you're not really paying attention exactly to what the message is all about. Drucker says the most important thing in communication is to hear what isn't being said. And you'll notice this throughout the talk today, that some of the scriptures that are quoted, how they leave out the important parts of the scripture. And so Peter Drucker says you can manipulate people if you just leave certain things out. And that's what these people are doing. And that's, I call that holding the truth in unrighteousness. Speaking a half-truth, then you are still misleading people. So the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Okay? When you go into a court of law and you're sworn to testify, and you testify, you're sworn to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Okay? Not just tell truth, period, because you can tell half-truth. You can leave out the other half that changes the story completely, and you can manipulate a jury with half-truths. You're sworn to tell the whole truth. Well, in this, the children of God are manifested and the children of the devil. Whoever does not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. These people are not doing righteousness. They are not of God. Galatians 5, you did run well. Who hindered you that you should not obey the truth? This persuasion comes not of him that calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. And it's very, very important that we not allow this leaven into our churches. Rick Warren says, the wrong question is, what shall I preach on? The right question is, whom will I be preaching to? Then I consider, what are their needs, hurts, and interests? And I ask a second question, what does the Bible say about their needs? See, he's already filtering the Word of God based on the people's needs. This is his own quotes. He's all concerned about their needs. Not, what does the Word of God say? See, the true man of God goes to the Bible and goes to God and says, what do you want me to tell these people? God gives them a message, and he gives them the message. Whether it's nice, whether it's not nice, whether it makes people walk out of his church or get upset with him, doesn't matter. He's to proclaim the message that God gives him. He's not to be looking at the audience first and saying, what are their needs, and how can I manipulate this message so I can make their needs met? Rick Warren asks himself then, what's the most practical way to say this, the most positive way to say this, the most encouraging way to say this, the simplest way, the most personal way, what's the most interesting way to say this? So he manipulates his message. Well, the result is a watered-down message filled with feel-good half-truths, no condemnation or conviction of sin for the listeners. Those who are accepting Christ are not accepting the Christ revealed in the blessed Word of God, but rather a false Christ, a Christ of only grace and love, not of judgment, lordship, and kingship, who exists to meet their needs and heal their hurts. Jesus now has become a servant of them rather than them becoming servants of him. Time magazine understands what's going on in these purpose-driven churches. It says, for purpose-driven church leaders, he has developed an evangelism strategy that includes a casual dress code, convenient parking, bright lights, live bands, short prayers, and simple sermons that accentuate the positive. No negative here. Second part of the definition, then, the church converts them and disciples them through the use of modern organizational management or total quality management style techniques. Here's a manipulation of the Word of God. Purpose-driven life, he says that the Bible says whoever accepts and trusts the Son gets in on everything, life complete and forever. That's accentuating the positive. Sounds good. King James says, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. He that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Little different message than getting in on everything. Well, here's Rick Warren's supposed conversion to Christianity. I invite you to bow your head and quietly whisper the prayer that will change your eternity. Jesus, I believe in you and I receive you. Go ahead. If you sincerely meant that prayer, congratulations. Welcome to the family of God. No repentance whatsoever. No depravity. No contriteness of spirit, brokenheartedness, none of that. Just, I believe you and I receive you. Okay, sounds good. Well, Ezekiel said, because with lies you have made the heart of the righteous sad, whom I have not made sad, and strengthen the hands of the wicked, that he should not return from his wicked way by promising him life. That's exactly what Rick Warren is doing. He is making the wicked people not turn away from their wicked way. He's promising them life when they're really still in death. True conversion happens here, Acts 3:19. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. That's what happens. Well, Warren says discipleship is switching from church building programs to a people building process. This is one of his models that he uses as you go through the 101 and 201 and 301 classes. And then he's also got a baseball diamond. Interestingly, at the top right there, or at the right-hand side, the first step is indoctrination. You have to be indoctrinated into this process. Well, what these four stages are then, first base, second base, and third base, or the 101, 201, 301. 101 is traditional. You come in as a traditional person. Stage two is transitional, and you start to accept their teachings. And then transformational, you now accept their teachings, and then you will defend it against the Word of God. Okay? You will justify your compromise, and somebody comes to you with an open Bible, and you're in a purpose-driven church, you'll defend your pastor and your church over the Word of God, even when proven wrong. You have now become transformational. And then the fourth stage is evangelical. Once you are in that position of compromise, you want others to compromise as well because you'll feel better about yourself. That's why the homosexual is now trying to convert the rest of society to accept it and celebrate their diversity, because if we can get everybody to celebrate us, we'll feel better about ourselves and we won't feel so guilty. And the same thing is happening in the purpose-driven churches. When you're saying, I'm out of church, I'm in a home church, and we're by ourselves doing our own hymns and Bible study, they'll be telling you, you're missing out. Oh boy, the music and the worship and the praise, and you're not supposed to be forsaking the assembling of yourselves, and you got to get back involved in this. And as long as you're outside, you're a thorn in their behind because of the fact that they know that they're compromising and you refuse to compromise and they still feel guilt. So they evangelize, but they're not evangelizing Christ and they're not evangelizing the gospel. They are evangelizing the process. Now, Reagan wasn't right on everything, but I like this statement that he made in 87. He says, how do you tell a communist? Well, it's someone who reads Marx and Lenin. And how do you tell an anti-communist? It's someone who understands Marx and Lenin. Saddleback's membership covenant, they have you sign covenants that you agree with their statements, strategy, and structure. Well, you don't understand their structure as a new believer. You don't understand the dialectic process, but you're just going to sign a document that says, I agree with your structure, which comes from Peter Drucker and Tom Patterson and Bob Buford. You are also going to sign a covenant against gossip. In other words, you can't dare question the leadership, even questioning it against the Word of God. You're to be committed to the leadership, you're to be committed to participate in small groups, and you're to be committed to tithe a minimum 10%. That is not biblical in the New Testament. Purpose-driven life. At Saddleback Church, every member has signed a covenant that includes a promise to protect the unity of our fellowship. That's the most important thing. The Bible is not the most important thing. The fellowship comes first, the Bible is secondary. Covenants. James tells us, but above all things, my brethren, swear not, neither by heaven, neither by earth, neither by any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your nay be nay, lest you fall into condemnation. So we're not supposed to be signing these church covenants. Why are they having you sign these covenants? So that they can manipulate you. If you start to fight against it, they'll wave the paper in your face and say you signed a covenant. Well, they also have spiritual gifts assessments, which are basically psychological profiling. They're based on the premise that God uses you in your areas of strength and passion or lusts, and it's databasing. This information can and will be fed back to the federal government, and we'll talk about that in the second half. Peter Drucker believes in human strengths to counter human weaknesses. The Word of God says, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, and in distresses for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then am I strong. God uses you often in areas where you're completely out of your comfort zone. You're completely no longer confident in yourself, but you have to place your confidence in Him. For me, throughout my life, I hate public speaking, and I still do not like it, and I'm not comfortable with it. But when Dean told me that he wanted me to speak at the first conference, I knew I had to, because God had given me a message, and He had given me a lot of research, and I knew that it had to be disseminated. And when Dean said, you need to come and speak it, I had no choice but to go and speak it, because that's what God was telling me to do. So God wasn't using me in an area where I was confident or feeling, my own strength. And so similarly, He's not going to use you in areas that you're confident in. He's glorified when somebody that's just completely, small in the eyes of the world suddenly does great things, and the only thing that they can do is glorify God as a result of it, because he gets the glory. Well, Christianity Today says that the science of discovering those strengths, fitting them into a productive framework, is what Drucker calls management. At best, this is fitting people to the task. It's not led by the Holy Spirit. And at worst, it's manipulating people to do their dirty work, which indeed it is. The pastor is becoming a CEO. And the pastor, as manager, has to identify the strengths and specialization, place them and equip them for service, and enable them to work in the harmonious and productive whole known as the body of Christ. Now, the pastor has taken God's place, because the Bible says, "For our comely parts have no need, but God has tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked. And God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondly prophets, thirdly teachers." So now, in the Drucker management scheme, the pastor has taken the place of God, and he's the one who's running the management scheme, rather than letting God and the Holy Spirit run the management scheme. The role of the pastor, then, leadership is shifting from pastor and staff as doers of ministry to being equippers of others in ministry. It's shifting from preaching and pastoral care to being proactive in leadership, vision casting, and centered on mission. And Rick Warren is selling canned sermons to the pastors so they don't have to bother wasting their time preparing a message for Sunday. They can just download it from pastors.com for a little fee, and that way they can be the manager and the CEO telling all the pegs where what holes they're supposed to be in. Well, the Bible says, "Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in the word and doctrine." The true biblical pastor should be laboring in the word and the doctrine as his first priority. Is that right, Pastor John?
Absolutely.
Thank you. So, small groups or cells. The Bible studies have become dialectic rather than didactic. They use numerous Bible versions, King James again avoided or actively discouraged, and the word is watered down. The way that this is, the didactic teaching, again, the teacher takes a message to the Bible study from God, and he gives them the message. It's fine to have discussion at the end of that. That's not a problem. Or if people have questions or they want to discuss things, that's not a problem, as long as that leader goes back to the Word of God to definitively answer the question. That's got to be the standard. What these dialectic sessions is they usually even have different leader every week, and the leader is a facilitator. The leader brings the message, which is, we'll talk about this particular scripture today, and then we'll have different people read it out of their different versions, and then we'll go around the room and ask everybody how they think and how they feel about the scripture today. And then some will say, "Well, I've got King James, and this says that God is a God of wrath," and somebody else has got the message, and the message is much softer about the whole thing. And so, you know, really the truth must be somewhere in the middle. You know, God's probably not quite as harsh as he was in that King James language, and the message isn't a very good one, so it's probably somewhere in between. And everybody agrees to disagree, and they achieve consensus, and they bond, and that's what it's all about. The bottom line is the Word of God is watered down. Purpose-Driven Life quotes 15 different translations and paraphrases, including Catholic, quote, Bibles. And in the theory and practice, again, those Marxist terms, theory and practice of translation, they say the older focus in translating was from the form of the message. The new focus, however, has shifted from the form of the message to the response of the receptor. So people are now actually translating the Word of God based on what response they expect to get from the people. And so again, we're no longer concerned about what is the Greek and what is the Hebrew and trying to get back to the original intent of the text, but now we're going further away from that and saying, well, what kind of response can we get from the people if we say it this way? Eugene Peterson, his message, and I won't call it a Bible, it says, "In the world of spirit, integrity, art, and imagination, Peterson stands high above the crowd. In this fresh paraphrase of Scripture, Peterson's exegetical deftness meets headlong with poetic brilliance forged in the fire of nearly 30 years of pastoring." So basically, whatever his experiences were, all went into this book, and that gives you a new thing called the message, which is not the Word of God. Eugene Peterson has a very interesting statement. He says, one of the devil's finest pieces of work is getting people to spend 3 nights a week in Bible study. Okay, so this is satanic. Bible study is satanic. I'm sure that's going to surprise a lot of readers, Mars Hill, who was interviewing him, says. Peterson says, well, why do people spend so much time studying the Bible? How much do you need to know? We invest all this time in understanding the text, which has a separate life of its own, and we think we're being more pious and spiritual when we're doing it, but it's all to be lived. It was given to us so we could live it, but most Christians know far more of the Bible than they're living. They should be studying it less, not more. You just need to know enough to pay attention to God. Interestingly, Rick Warren says basically the same thing. Purpose-driven life. The last thing many believers need today is to go to another Bible study. They already know far more than they are putting into practice. What they need are serving experiences in which they can exercise their spiritual muscles. So we need to just be in experience and bonding and forget about the didactic teaching of the Word of God. It's a denial of these scriptures. The Word of God is quick, it's alive, it's powerful, and it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The Word has a life of its own, it is alive, and it's powerful, and it's Satan's best work to keep you out of it and tell you don't go to another Bible study, because Satan knows that the Scripture has power. You can't deny the power. The Word of God says, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. So if you're not studying it, how can it accomplish anything in your life? You've got to be in the Bible more and more, and rather than in these paraphrases, back to the Greek and the Hebrew and getting deeply into the original intent of the Scriptures. Okay, because these people here, they have a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. They are denying the power of the Word of God. From these people, we are told to turn away. Small groups or cells are the most effective way of closing the back door of your church. Rick Warren says, this is the bonding. They've done research. If your 7 best friends go to your church, you won't leave no matter how bad the teaching gets because you've bonded with those 7 relationships. So that's what they want to do. They want you to get into their, quote, knitting ministries, their skiing ministries, their bicycling ministries. They call these ministries. And they want you to bond and get you tied into the small groups because you won't give it up once you've made those bonding relationships. This is straight from Kurt Lewin, again, a transformational Marxist, who says it's easier to change individuals formed into a group than to change any one of them separately. Purpose-driven life says, Jesus ministered in the context of a small group of disciples. He knew 12 is about the maximum size you can have in a small group if everyone is to participate. This is another lie. Okay, everybody, this wasn't group participation in a small group. This was 12 disciples listening to the master and taking the message from the master. It was only going one way. It was going from Jesus to them. They weren't in a dialectic session where everybody was sharing their feelings and their thoughts and Jesus agreeing to disagree with them. Social ministries then, they want you to develop these friendships and relationships. Accountability groups, and this reminds me of a conversation I had with my wife this morning. The accountability groups, they're having the men confess to each other or the women confess to each other, and again, everybody gets all their dirty laundry out there, and then, you know, everybody says they're going to pray for them and all of that stuff, and it does several things. First is it makes you more concerned about what your accountability group is going to say to you rather than what God is saying to you. So if you're thinking of entering into a sin, you're worried about what the group on Tuesday night is going to say about it when you talk about that, as opposed to having the notion that, gee, God is looking at me right now, and he knows right now, and so I better not do this because he's not going to be pleased. So it shifts accountability from God to man. It also, you know, Jesus promises that he will remove your sins as far as the east is from the west. These people in these groups won't forget. And as soon as you turn against the group or don't agree with what the group is doing, all of a sudden those things are going to come back at you, and they're going to say, oh, we know about this, you're not so perfect there, and you know, who do you think you are challenging this group? Well, also, as far as the men's side of it is, this is what Promise Keepers has done to the men, and it's a very normal phenomenon for females to kind of spill their guts or gossip or talk about details of their lives. And I was talking to my wife about it this morning, because last night she went to a candle party. They were selling candles, and she was saying, you know, that, you know, really just kind of like turned out, you know, all the women are gossiping and this and that about their husbands and blah blah blah, and you know, and all of this stuff. And I told her before she went, I said, you know, that's just a dialectic session, and to be part of the group, you're going to buy some candles because you're not going to want to go against the group. Well, she bought some candles. But anyway, women do that naturally. It's like a common thing. There's Bunko, a card game that women play, and they gossip and all of this stuff, and that's kind of a not unusual phenomenon for matriarchal. But that's what Promise Keepers started doing for men, to feminize the men and get them into the accountability groups and spilling their guts and this and that and the other thing, interacting like women. That's what these accountability groups are doing. They are feminizing the men. It leads to role-playing and eventual sin and failure to the people in the groups, and that's been shown in Promise Keepers as well, that the people think, well, gee, you know, okay, Joe, he's a good guy, and he's got a solid marriage, you know, but he cheated on his wife, and, you know, I still think of him as a good Christian and everything, and so, you know, maybe I can actually get away with that, too, and, I mean, there's been a lot of failure in these Promise Keeper groups. Also, then, there's submission to the group because you're afraid to go against them now because, again, they've got the dirt on you. And then also the needs, hurts, and problems are being fed back to the pastor, who then preaches on those things, and everybody says, gee, what, Matt, look at that, how the Holy Spirit worked. I was struggling with this problem, and the pastor preached about it today. And then, again, it stifles opposition. You don't dare cross the group once you've been involved in these things. Purpose-driven life says, make this your common practice, confess your sins one to another, and pray for each other so that you can live together whole and healed. Again, he takes this from Eugene Peterson's The Message. But the Bible does not say anything about this being your common practice. It does say, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So, yes, on an individual basis, when I want to talk to a close friend who I can trust about a particular problem I'm having and ask for their prayer to help me to gain strength in that area, then that's fine. It's not to be every single week. It's not to be before a group on a regular basis. This is the return to Catholicism, basically. I'm a former Catholic, and this is also the submission. When you're going into the confessional and you're spilling your guts, you are submitting to the authority of that priest in the church. And we've also seen that there's a lot of failure on the part of those priests who are being confessed to, as we've seen in the Catholic Church recently. Well, this confession phenomenon, Edward Hunter, he's the one who coined the term brainwashing. He says there's something intrinsic in communism that makes this confession phenomenon indispensable to it. It can't exist without it. The meaning in confession, then, as the Reds now use it, is agreement with the rules laid down and hence submission to the existing hierarchy. So this is part of the brainwashing technique. The Word of God says there's one God, one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. That's who we're to be concerned about confessing our sins to. That way we will always know who we're accountable to, and then when we're thinking of entering into a sin, we know who's right there watching us as we try to do it. Career development ministries are also databasing, and that will be shared with the federal government. What they're doing is they're having everybody put in, what are your talents? What are your hobbies? What's your job? What things can you do? And how can you offer this in service to the church? And actually the church is now giving service to the community and giving service to the world. And so they're, again, gathering all this information and then using it to place you for service, because the pastor's, the CEO, is going to tell you that you're going to go down to the inner city and build a house for somebody that needs it. Church purity or twisting scripture. Rick Warren says that Regarding church purity, Jesus said, "Let the tares and the wheat grow together, and one day I'll sort them out." We're not in the sorting business, we're in the harvesting business. So this is his justification for bringing unbelievers into the church, is that Jesus said, "Let the tares grow up among the wheat." Okay? Well, there's a few problems with that. First, Jesus is very much interested in purity within the church. Matthew 18 talks about biblical restoration, and if you can't restore the person, then excommunication from the church to keep the church pure. We're also, 1 Corinthians 5, we're not to even eat with sinning Christians. Ephesians 5, Jesus wants to present himself a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, holy and without blemish. And 1 Timothy 1, Paul delivered Hymenaeus and Alexander to Satan that they learn not to blaspheme. Jesus is interested in church purity. Well, also, 1 Corinthians 5 says, "What have I to do to judge those who are outside? Don't you judge those that are within?" In other words, you're supposed to be judging those who are within. But those who are outside, God will judge. Therefore, put away from among yourselves that wicked person. So get them out of the church, and then God will deal with them. But this is also a twist of Scripture, talking about the wheat and the tares. Because Jesus, in Matthew 13, gave us the biblical exegetical meaning of that text. It only has one meaning, and it had nothing to do with the church, because the field is the world, not the church. It says the devil is the one who sows the tares, which are the children of the wicked one, and the harvest is the end of the world. So when Rick Warren tries to apply this to be the church, having tares in the church, and taking a tare out of the church would be considered harvesting, he's completely does not understand or refuses to understand the proper exegetical meaning of the text, because Jesus gave us the true text. So he twists this, and again, he uses it to justify his sowing of tares into the church. And if he's the one sowing the tares into the church, he's put in place himself in the place of the devil, because the devil's the one who's sowing tares. We're not supposed to be deliberately bringing unbelievers into the church. What we're supposed to be doing is evangelizing outside, and once they're evangelized, then bring them into the church. 2 Peter 3:16, also in all of his epistles, speaking in them of these things, which are some things hard to be understood, but they who are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures unto their own destruction. In other words, some scriptures are difficult to understand, but also other scriptures are very clear. And I just showed you, Matthew 13 was a very clear scripture that nobody should have a misunderstanding about. But these unlearned and unstable people wrestle or twist these scriptures unto their own destruction. Rick Warren, again, he says, we're not in the sorting business. However, he contradicts himself. He says, God is very clear that we are to confront those who cause division among Christians. And then he quotes the NIV and says, warn a divisive person once and then warn him a second time. After that, have nothing to do with him. No, that's not talking about divisive people. King James says that it's a man who is a heretic after the first and second admonition reject. Well, Rick Warren has had many admonitions via emails, via conversations. He's had many, many admonitions. He's to be rejected because he is a heretic. Rick Warren says, when you're helping to row the boat, you don't have time to rock it. In other words, shut up and keep rowing. He also recommends this book, a wonderful tool I recommend to every church serious about being purpose-driven. And there's an entire chapter dealing with opposition. And the opposition that they're dealing with is biblically based believers who are didactic thinkers who refuse to change and come on with the new flow of ideas. They say that you have three basic choices with power brokers. These are the powerful people in the church. Get them on board, fight them, or run them off. So all of a sudden, when he says he's not in the sorting business, he's sorting certain people out. In dealing with dissenters, they claim that you're gossiping against them. They claim that you violate Matthew 18. We already saw examples of that today. Matthew 18 deals with biblical excommunication. Okay? Somebody steals something from you. You're the only one that knows about it. You go, you're somebody from the church. You go and you talk to him personally and say, give me my thing back and I'll forgive you and we can move on. And he says, no, I refuse to. Then you take two or three people and you've got the evidence of him stealing those things, and then he still refuses to be restored. So then you take it to the whole congregation and he still refuses to be restored. Then you biblically excommunicate him from the church. This is not talking about public policy of Saddleback Church. Saddleback Church is putting this public policy in books, in video, teleconferences, all of these things. That's public issues. And so public issues in the church can be dealt with publicly. But as soon as you start to go against them, like David Jeremiah, he misquotes the scripture and says, no, you should have come to me personally. No, you had a public policy, we addressed it publicly. It's biblical. They claim that you're the one causing the division, that you're the one who's sowing discord among brethren, and they claim to be martyred by you. Well, in dealing with opposition, these people are not dealing with satanic opposition. They are talking about opposition from Bible-believing Christians who are holding firm to the Word.
In 1957, the New York Crusade really clarified in a way that the fact that there was a difference between evangelical and fundamentalist in that sense. And you said we'd had enough of the big stick, as it were, of fundamentalism, and we needed the big love of evangelicalism. There is a division between those two words that people still don't altogether understand.
Well, it's certainly true here in this country. There's a difference between the fundamentalist, who is a person who takes a stand on certain controversial issues and won't move from that stand, and there's an intolerance. And I felt that God had called me to love all people, whatever church they went to, whether it's Catholic or Protestant or who, and work with them.
So he talks about the intolerance of the fundamentalist. Look at his body language. It seems like he's a little bit intolerant there. Anyway, Rick Warren then. Again, he says that they're not in the sorting business, but he says, be willing to let people leave the church. And I told you earlier the fact that people are going to leave the church no matter what you do, but when you define the vision, you're choosing who leaves. You say, but Rick, yes, they're the pillars of the church. Now, you know what pillars are. Pillars are people who hold things up. And in your church, you may have to have some blessed subtractions before you have any real additions. So they call them blessed subtractions. Some of these books that you read about, Leading Your Church Through Change, it talks about how we lost 500 people from the church, but then we replaced it with 2,000 other people. And it says, the pastor says, I would do the same thing in a New York minute, you know, given the same opportunity. They get rid of the traditional people out of the church, and they bring in all of these transitional and transformational thinkers. So who do they sort out? Well, here's this church, Gardendale Baptist Church. It says, love unconditionally at the bottom here. Love each other as Christ loved the church. Okay? That's part of their mission statement. That was before they ousted 165 members. Based on this statement, they had to have a vote on this statement. Pastor Micah is the God-called pastor for Gardendale and is leading us in God's direction or not. They also stated in the letter that he would leave immediately if the church voted against him. And if the church votes for me to stay, those who vote against me will be removed from membership in the family immediately. So this was obviously a ballot that had your name on it. And if you voted no, you were out. It says, our church is totally committed to teaching people in the community. Some people were willing to sacrifice some personal preferences and traditions, and some were not willing to do that. So the people that held to the traditions of the Word of God, and this all happened right after they did their 40 Day of Purpose campaign, and they ousted 165 people. And actually, I would say they were blessed subtractions, because it says, blessed are you when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company and shall reproach you and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. So they truly are blessed subtractions. Well, pragmatism, the end justifies the means. Rick Warren says, I contend that when a church continues to use methods that no longer work, it is being unfaithful to Christ. So Noah as a preacher of righteousness for 120 years, got seven other family members on the boat with him. Apparently, in the world's eyes, he was utilizing methods that weren't continuing to work. And according to Rick Warren, he would be unfaithful to Christ. But according to the book of Hebrews, it says, by faith, Noah. Well, it is transformational thinking. It's the justification of why it is you don't have to attend to the facts. Rick Warren says, as long as you're bringing people to Christ, into the fellowship of his family, building them up to maturity, training them for ministry, and sending them out in mission, I like the way you're doing ministry. I don't care how you got them there. I don't care how you did it. I like it. Mother Teresa said, it's not what you do, but how much love you put into it that matters. So it doesn't matter what you do. If you're a prostitute and you do it with a lot of love, that's what really counts. And that's quoted in Rick Warren's book. He quotes Mother Teresa there. God's answer to pragmatism, though, is if the truth of God has more abounded by my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner? See, we can't lie people into the kingdom of God. Well, my arguments against this pragmatic approach is that they're not coming to the Christ revealed in the Scriptures. They are accepting a false Christ, a Christ that does not require them to repent, a Christ that is not also a righteous judge and a God of wrath. And then secondly, this building and training process and sending process is structured on the godless or satanic diaprox method, and so you cannot be using this for God's glory. The Word of God says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, haven't we prophesied in your name, and in your name cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works? And I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. A lot of people are doing a lot of busy work in all of these churches where the pastor's telling them how to serve their community, but these people, many of them, don't know God, and God never knew them. Well, pragmatism is a symptom. It's not the disease. The root of this, unfortunately, runs far deeper.
We're just not afraid to fail. We've always seen Saddleback as kind of an R&D, kind of a Bell Labs for Christianity. We try something, it doesn't work. We try something else, it doesn't work. 99 out of 100 don't work. We find one that works. Then we go out and teach a seminar and pretend like we knew what we were doing in the first place. He is attempting to multiply his ministry through the ministries of others by making what he has extracted in terms of principle from his research and development project at Saddleback available to pastors worldwide.
This is what Saddleback Church is. It's not a church. Is there a scriptural basis for pastors to use their churches as human behavioral science laboratories and research and development laboratories? And is this behavior modification? The Leadership Network, founded by Bob Buford and Peter Drucker, say that change and transition are not the same. Change is an event, something that happens. Transition is the emotional and psychological processing of the change. This is brainwashing. Robert Schuller founded the Crystal Cathedral and authored Self-Esteem, The New Reformation. Reverend Bill Hybels founded Willow Creek Community Church, the other cue ball church. He had monthly meetings with Bill Clinton as his spiritual advisor during his presidency, and it was at that church that he went and supposedly asked for forgiveness over his affair with Monica Lewinsky. He was supposedly repentant that day, but then 4 days later at the Democratic National Convention, he said that he would fight for the rest of his life for a woman's right to choose. Willow Creek, Bill Hybels' office, like the rest of his church, has no religious icons, but it displays a framed dictum from management theorist Peter Drucker. What is our business? Who is our customer? What does the customer consider value? The corporate tone of Willow Creek is obvious to anyone, including this secular magazine called Civilization. Again, this book comes out of Willow Creek, Building a Church of Small Groups, a place where nobody stands alone. Carl George says the consequences of this change are that many, many people are being provoked to love and good works through healthy, reproductive small groups. To a certain extent, even the foundations of our society are being rebuilt through this lay-driven movement. This is not from God. This is from laity. They said that I knew my best efforts and gifts would have to be put against the task of building a church of small groups no matter what. So I don't care how much opposition I'm getting. I don't care whether somebody comes to me with an open Bible and proves to me it's not biblical. I don't care. I'm doing it. They talk about community. They've twisted the word koinonia and now talk about community.
Another nonprofit institution that has attracted Drucker's attention is the megachurch. These fast-growing churches have attracted huge numbers of Americans over the past decades.
My interest in the megachurches was as a social phenomenon. I saw them creating community for these young, educated, successful professionals who, in 9 cases out of 10, were rootless, came out of the small town or the farm or the working class, and now in the big city, and very successful in their work, and had no community. And this is the need or the opportunity which a mega church exploits.
God wants to use people in your life. You can't grow without others.
Very telling statements by Peter Drucker. He talks about the young, educated, successful professionals. He's talking about money. He says that they have this need for community, and it says this need is the opportunity that the megachurch exploits. Purpose-driven life says every Christian needs to be involved in a small group within their church. This is where real community takes place. What is this definition of community? Well, in the Church of Small Groups, it says, our Bible study of 35 people, half of whom did not know Christ, then the church shut us down. True community was shelved. So this is not biblical koinonia among believers. This is dialectic process and consensus among believers mixed with unbelievers. This is not from God. Community is a diverse group of people. We're told we're not to be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, or that fellowship term there is koinonia, and what communion, also koinonia, has light with darkness. So community is obviously not biblical koinonia. You can't have koinonia with unbelievers. Interesting, they redefine God. They say this plurality of beings comes to consensus to create humans in their image. They create in their collective image God rightly defined and understood as community, or in other words, a diverse group. Jesus rejects that. He says, I and my Father are one. Okay, we didn't have a diverse group, the dialogue consensus, decide to make man. Well, they say without an ounce of sacrilege, we might call the Godhead the first small group. No, that's not an ounce of sacrilege, that's a ton of sacrilege. And we are created in God's image, therefore we are created for community. The Word of God says God created man in his own image, in the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. Purpose-driven life also says we're created for community. They say that our successes and our glories are not the stuff of community, but our sins and failures are. And that bottom line is that's where you have true fellowship with believers and unbelievers. The only place you have common ground is that we all have a depraved, sinful nature. And so if we all agree on that aspect, then we're all in our depravity together. Church of Small Groups says community experience through small group relationships is a necessity, not an option for those of us who bear his name. And they also say we must run persistently against all that destroys community. Well, St. Origen in the 3rd century defined sin as the lack of conformity to the revealed will of God through the refusal of the creature to be related to the Creator by faith. That's the old definition of sin. The new definition of sin is running persistently against all that destroys community. In other words, the new definition of sin is anything that breaks up relationship. Paul Tillich, dialectical humanism, he says sin is the estrangement of man from man. This is a transformational Marxist. So the Church of Small Groups sounds a lot closer to the transformational Marxist than it sounds to the Word of God or the sin as defined by Origen. Church of Small Groups says only a sociopath, defined as one departed from the norm, ultimately rejects relationship. So if you break up the small group, you're a sociopath.
A quote. If ever there was a woman called of God to proclaim the scriptures, my daughter Anne is one. She's one of the great Bible teachers among women today. I have a great appreciation for her and other women who have a gift of God. Does that mean that you are in favor of the ordination of women?
It would be according to the circle I was in, because I feel that I belong to all the churches. I'm equally at home in an Anglican or Baptist church or Brethren Assembly or Roman Catholic church. And I would have to say that I would identify with the customs and the culture and the theology of that particular church.
Homosexual pastors, then, I guess he would have to agree with that. He agrees with the ordination of females when he's in a church that's pastored by a female. He agrees with the priests in the Roman Catholic churches. Just like Dean said, your negatives are what define you. If you have no negatives, you have no, how do you say it? No identity. And that's what Billy Graham is. He has absolutely no identity anymore. He's agreeing with everybody. Fenelon says that he was an Archbishop of Cambrai in France, advisor of court of Louis XIV in the 17th century. He said, "You must be willing to yield to the will of God whenever he decides to remove you from you all of the props on which you have leaned. Sometimes you must give up even your most spiritual friends if they are props. And why does he take human help away except to supply you from himself and to purify you by the painful lesson?" So we must not be dependent on our human relationship. God may take away those human relationships just so that we become more dependent on him. Church of Small Group says, "Not only are you God's image bearer created for community, but you are designed to seek God and enjoy interdependence with him." That means they're saying that God is to some degree dependent upon you. Purpose-driven study guide says, "God didn't need to create you, but he chose to create you for his own enjoyment. You exist for his benefit, his glory, his purpose, and his delight." So he needs something from us. But Philippians 2:13 says, "It's God which works in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure." So he just works his good pleasure through our life. It's not that we're doing anything that's pleasing him. Pagan Glossary says that a magic circle is used as a focus of power for rituals, visualized as a doorway between dimensions. And a cone of power is a combined psychic energy of a group mind focused through a magical circle, directed by a unified will and sent forth to work outside the circle. This is Rick Warren's diagram. You have the group mind, and once you do the 101 and 201 and 301 classes, then you are sent outside to do work outside the circle. Now, I know that sounds like maybe a little bit of a stretch. I've also seen bumper stickers talk about witches doing it in circles. And the bottom line is, I will state that dialectic small groups are nothing more than circles where witchcraft is performed, and to participate is to become involved in witchcraft. The Pagan Glossary says, "Reclaiming, in particular, aggressively combats hierarchy, utilizing consensus rather than voting in their decision-making, having a rotating pool of speakers in public gatherings, etc., still working it out." Well, Church of Small Groups says, "To yield here will compromise your ability to create a thriving network of little communities that have virtually unlimited redemptive potential in your church." So they say that there is power in these small groups, and they have redemptive potential. It gets worse. They say that a man confesses his arrogance and toxic communication to the group and asks for forgiveness. This group now holds the keys to life and death, blessing and curse. Well, if you read Revelation 1:18 and Deuteronomy 11:26, those are attributes of God. And so they're saying the small group becomes God when these things happen. They say that by receiving confession, proclaiming forgiveness, and embracing the man with love and respect, this group can make a quantum leap into a new level of community, a new level of the evolutionary process. And Bill Hybel says, "The church is the hope of this world, and its future rests in the hands of its leaders." Okay, and this is not talking about Christ being the head of the church. This is talking about church leaders being the hope of the world. Bob Buford, who we've talked about a lot, he refers to Peter Drucker as the man who formed my mind. Fortunately, I believe God formed my mind. He wrote this book, Halftime, Changing Your Game Plan from Success to Significance. He talks about the first half of your life, which is basically didactic. The second half, the midlife crisis, which is your time of transition. And then the second half of your life, after halftime, which is now, he calls it significance, but it's transformation. And he talks about how you change your mind. He says, Rick Warren says, I want every man in my congregation to read this inspiring story. Well, this inspiring story on chapter 5 says, in my time of deepest need, grace led me to an atheist. Grace isn't very nice. What this book is about is how he had his first half of success in life, and then he and his wife and an atheist put themselves in a beach house for a weekend, and he consulted this atheist as to how he could better serve God for the second half of his life. The atheist gave him the answers, and then he goes ahead and writes this book about how the atheist has shown him the light as to how he can better serve God in the second half of his life. And Rick Warren wants everybody in his congregation to read this inspiring story. Well, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. We're not to be consulting atheists to give us direction in life. We're not to be going to the palm reader or the psychic or any of those people trying to find out what we're supposed to do in the second half of our life. Buford says there's two books in his office, Peter Drucker's Large Book Management as his guide for human things, and the Bible is his guide for spiritual things. Personally, I believe that my Bible should be my guide for all things. And the scripture says a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. I'll skip a couple of these things. Purpose-driven life says the Bible knows nothing of solitary saints or spiritual hermits isolated from other believers and deprived of fellowship. But again, the Word of God is very clear. It says, I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land that I should not destroy it, but I found none. So the Lord was looking for one man who could stand alone. He wasn't looking for a small group. And this whole idea that everything has to be done in group is completely contrary to what the scriptures say. Buford says, I've never done anything important outside the context of a team. I can't recall a single thing worth doing that I've accomplished by myself. That's unfortunate. That means he's not a Christian. Okay? Because a one-on-one relationship with God, that happens on an individual basis. It doesn't happen in group. And Jesus gave us that example. In the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He forsook the relationship as a guide to us, as a model to us, that we have to forsake relationships if we're going to serve God properly. And he set aside that relationship so that he could take on the sin of the world and cause the single most tremendous event in human history as a model for us that some relationships we're going to have to lose if we're going to follow him. Significance. He calls it community or gestalt or synergy. You only take on significance or worth or quality as you relate to the group and function as a part of that group, and they say that the sum is equal, greater than the parts. This is power, the power of the small groups, the sum greater than the parts. This is one of our local billboards. It says, do you see a study group? Then you see the power of community coalitions. There's power in the group. My former employer had this out, labor plus management to the power of P, the power of partnership. When labor and management work together as equals, okay, management's supposed to be above labor, you know, they're the boss and the labor work for them. When labor and management work together as equals, we create the power of partnership, a power that is greater than the sum of its parts. Synergy is defined by the pagans as the combined effect of several agencies such that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Buford again says significance always requires a change of attitude, a personal paradigm shift. major changes in one's systems of perceptions, beliefs, values, and feelings. So if your original perceptions and feelings or beliefs are based on the Word of God, you always must change that attitude in order to become significant, Buford says. The Training Network for Disciple-Making Churches say that they believe that change is vital to any congregation's ability to be renewed and reformed, but before change can occur, values must be adjusted or clarified so that people see the need for change. People have to see the need for change. So the paradigm shift here is that individualism must become collectivism. Religions, again, must be merged, and sovereign nations must be merged as well. Peter Drucker, Shaping the Managerial Mind, he is a person who helps people see the need for change. They say that he changes as the world changes. He's supposedly a Christian. He shouldn't be changed by the world. Well, Peter Drucker, it says, is the man who formed Bob Buford's mind. And Donald Keough, retired president of Coca-Cola, said, "Drucker purified my mind." I personally wouldn't brag about it if somebody brainwashed me. Drucker says, "We're creating tomorrow's society of citizens through the social sector, through your nonprofit, and in that society, everybody's a leader, everybody is responsible, and everybody acts." Everybody's a leader. And that's what you see in all these church growth churches. It's all about leadership. Let's go leadership training. Leadership, leadership, leadership. Well, if you've got everybody's a leader, then who's following? I mean, just by definition, the term leader means he's got somebody following. If everybody's a leader, it makes no sense. Anyway, the Word of God says, "My brethren, be not many masters." We shouldn't have many leaders in the church, knowing that we shall receive greater condemnation. You're accountable. If you go into leadership, you're that much more accountable to God. And he's warning you, don't do it if you're not ready for that. "And be therefore followers of God as dear children." That's what we need to be. We need followership training. We need everybody to be trained to be a follower of God, not puffed up, "I'm a leader, follow me." Well, Warren Bennis from USC, he says, "The manager administers and the leader innovates. The manager accepts the status quo. The leader challenges it." So who in the Bible is our first example of a leader who challenged the status quo? The serpent was more subtle than the beast of the field which Lord God had made, and he said unto the woman, "Yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden." The first person in the Bible who challenged the status quo was the serpent. Well, leadership is a social process whereby people allow individuals' influence to direct them towards a desired change once they see the need for change. But wait a second. Why are you going to allow people to tell you to change when they won't tell you what you're changing to? They just tell you you're changing. And that's this whole book out of Willow Creek. It says how to change your church without killing. I read the whole book. It doesn't tell you what you're changing the church to. You're just changing. Notice that you have a downhill spiral on their cover. Rick Warren refers to his plans to change the world using pastors as his stealth strategy. And my question for that is, why does he have to fly under the radar? Why is it that he has these subtle things that he doesn't want to tell you what they are? He's going to use an undermining hidden strategy, and he'll tell you about it later.
Go to a computer store, and you find all these computers, and they'll have different brands. Micron, AST, Compaq, Dell, IBM, things like that. They all have different programs, different sizes, shapes, types. But inside every one of those is a little chip. An Intel chip that make it's the process that makes it run. And I believe that whether on the your church title says First Lutheran or Second Nazarene or Third Baptist or whatever, that what you need to say is, do you have a process that helps you fulfill the purposes of God?
Yeah.
Process is what he's putting into the church. Christianity Today says Drucker's a Christian. We already talked about that. Drucker says that they bring the world into the organization. Mega churches, new Catholic, Methodist, and Pentecostal religions survived because they innovated in response to social change. In other words, as the world changed, the church adapted. Otherwise, they would have died. Well, not if you believe in the Word of God. Are these atheistic, humanistic marketing and organizational management techniques promoted by people like Drucker the models that we should be basing our churches upon? No. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that brings not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire, the Word of God says. This total quality management style marketing and organizational management technique is a satanic, godless foundation, and the church should never be based on it. The Word of God says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God, and I say also unto you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." The church is based on that foundational statement by Peter that Christ is the Son of the living God. That is the rock-solid foundation that the church is to be based on. No other foundation can man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. That is the foundational statement. That is what the church is to be based on. Not on Drucker, not on Buford, not on Warren, not on Schuller, on Christ. Now the Spirit speaks expressly that in the latter days some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, like Peter Drucker, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. But evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Are these people deceived? Perhaps. Are they deceiving people? Yes. If they're deceived themselves, does that make them not accountable to God? No. They're still accountable to God. A lot of people say, well, do they know what they're doing? There's no question in my mind Warren knows what he's doing. From numerous emails and numerous arguments where he's had biblical arguments brought against him, and he absolutely rejects them and argues against them and demonizes the people who fight against him, I know he knows exactly what he's doing. This is a particular example of it, modernreformation.org. I call it Rick's damage control. These people are reformed in their theology. Rick is having an interview with them, and he complains that people are emailing him, on the one side saying he's too much reformed in his theology, and on the other side, too liberal in his theology. Well, when he's talking to modernreformation.org, he only quotes the scriptures out of purpose-driven life that go along with Reformed theology. He leaves out all of these other scriptures with his Arminian bent that he puts in purpose-driven life, where he's saying you must choose where you're going to be in eternity. You know, it's all up to your choice and all up to you. He ignores that when he's talking to the Reformers. And so he knows enough about both sides of the coin to pick and choose depending on what audience he's talking to. So there's no question in my mind he knows exactly what he's doing. He talks about the Nehemiah principle. Vision and purpose must be restated every 26 days to keep the church moving in the right direction. Make sure you communicate your purpose at least monthly. He says a message must be communicated 7 times before it really sinks in. He speaks of creative redundancy and restate your purpose on a regular basis. Teach it over and over. This is brainwashing. Edward Hunter, again, who coined the term brainwashing, says learning and confession are parallel rituals. For as the victim absorbs Marxist teaching, he is obliged to rid himself of the burden and the poisons of his old ideas by confession, cleansing his mind himself, achieving mind reform. So these people are being forced into their accountability groups, confession, 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 and they're being restated purposes over and over and over, creative redundancy. Talk about the message 26 times before it sinks in. We're going to get rid of you're going to confess out your old didactic thinking, and we're going to put in our new dialectic thinking into your mind. Confessions then lead to submission and accountability. Learnings are the indoctrination, restating your purposes. Apostle Paul said, "I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God." Rick Warren claims to have a truly balanced church, but he's spending all of his time restating his purposes and his 5 principles over and over and over again. He has no time to go through the entire Word of God and give people the whole counsel of God, as Paul spoke of. He does not have a balanced church. Church champions recommend behind the stained glass windows, money dynamics in the church, how to increase giving in your church, a video series by George Barna, and 44 ways of expanding the financial base of your congregation. They said that the hope was to increase missions giving, but because of the resistance to the plan, the project took a new direction, seeking to identify the resistance and examine in the field the attitudes towards funding to churches. So at first they were trying to get people to increase their giving. Then they found resistance, so they had to identify the resistance to find out how they could break through that resistance and get people to give more. Well, it's not about money, folks. It's about big money. In 1994, Rick Warren led the people at Saddleback Church in a faith commitment that included a one-day cash offering of $1.4 million and a commitment to give $22 million over the following 36 months. In 97, using the same program, the people at Saddleback gave $3 million as a one-time offering and pledged to give $31 million over the next 36 months. This is how he does it. This is his whole building blocks to reach your commitment. It says a little consistency builds a lot. And he starts at the top left there with a weekly. If you give only $2,000 a week, you'll give $8,600 a month, and in 3 years, you'll give $312,000. If you're all the way down at the bottom, $10 a week, that's $43 a month, and it'll be $1,560 in 3 years. And then they've got your weekly gift, your monthly gift, your annual gift, and then other pledges as you would like to give. In 1995, he claimed almost an $80,000 tax exemption for clergy housing expenses in 1 year. That's pretty good. John Maxwell founded Enjoy Ministries, a church consulting firm. He formerly was a pastor at Skyline Community Church, but God apparently uncalled him to be a pastor. And he specializes in stewardship. And the Leadership Network says that his stewardship seminar may rub some traditions the wrong way, but he has great practical ideas and gives pastors confidence to talk about a very spiritual subject. So it's uncomfortable because he's telling you how to squeeze money out of your congregation, but it's very spiritual that you do that. And then New Man Magazine says that's success to the max. Well, the Word of God says, what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his soul, or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? If any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds, and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain, or church growth, is godliness, from such withdraw yourself. Other promoters, Howard Hendricks, former Dallas Cowboys minister, Elmer Towns, Jerry Falwell. Here, Falwell steps outside the box and partnered with Rick Warren and the Purpose Driven Life. Richard Mao, president of Fuller Theological Seminary, which is where Rick Warren got his degree. He supports multiculturalism and diversity, and he supports rights and benefits for committed same-sex partners, but believes the sacrament of marriage should be confined to the heterosexual couples in the Judeo-Christian tradition. Seminaries that are promoting this process: Fuller, Dallas, Wheaton College, Trinity International, Liberty, Biola, Azusa Pacific, Beeson Divinity School. This interesting business aspect is Kenneth Ulmer, one of the black pastors in L.A., bought the Forum where the Lakers used to play. And he quotes, he says, Kenneth Ulmer says, Jesus said, do business till I return, and that's our plan. And they're going to market it as a convention and conference site, especially for Christian-oriented events. Well, after he bought it, the first Christian-oriented event that he had was an AC/DC conference or concert, which AC/DC stands for Antichrist Devil's Child, if you're not aware of that. And that was on a Saturday night. The next Sunday morning was Easter Sunday, and that's when they had their first church services, was within about 12 hours of the AC/DC concert. Years ago, Pastor John was on the radio late at night at KKLA that he spoke about earlier, and I heard him, and he was mainly talking about the black pastors and how they were taking the black people for a ride and just getting their money from them, squeezing them for money, and driving these fancy cars and things like that. And this was as I was learning the information about the church growth and Rick Warren and the manipulation process. So I called Pastor John up, and I started talking to him, and I told him that they're doing this manipulation in the white churches as well, but there's more to it. There's manipulation to it, and you need to know this information. You need to put this out on the radio. I'll get you the information. He says, no, you need to come on the radio with me. Here I am back with my public speaking thing. I'm saying, no. Let me give you the information. You're the radio guy. Here's the information. He says, no. He says, you give me the information, and I'll do about 3 weeks of leading up to it, and you're going to come into the booth with me at the end of the month, and we'll talk about it. Anyway, so I was telling him about Hybels and Warren and Schuller, and he was telling me about Kenneth Ulmer and all these other guys. Finally, was it last year or 2 years ago, they finally joined together in a conference. And this conference here held at Tony Evans Church has Kenneth Ulmer and Bill Hybels and Rick Warren. So about 4 or 5 years after we first joined together, we were on these paths, and we were on the trails of all of these different pastors, and sure enough, they all congealed and came together, which proved we were right all along. Church consultants then in favor of this stuff is Barna, Maxwell. We talked about most of these people already. TNET says leaders need ongoing coaching because developing people is a process, and you can't teach a process with an event. You teach a process through a process. Full training to produce lasting change lasts about 1,000 days. Leaders need to work together in teams to break through barriers that normally impede real transformational progress. And there's positive peer pressure between churches as they regularly report to each other what they have accomplished. There's built-in accountability in the process that the team has taken the time and the church has invested the money, so there's an expectation of tangible results. One of the things that happens is the church consultant comes to the church and knocks on the door and talks to the pastor, and he's got a portfolio with him. And he says, I'm a Christian. And the pastor doesn't question him and say, what's that mean? And he says, and I'm a church consultant, and here are these churches, and here's a congregation of 300 that's now 2,500, and here's another one that's 500 that's now 10,000. We've done all of these great things using these principles. For $20,000 or $40,000, we can implement the program in your church. And so the pastor buys it. He thinks, well, this is great. We're going to do great things for God. And, you know, that's a noble goal at first. But then, as they get into it and they realize that they have to do this blessed subtraction thing and kick out the old people in the church and bring in the new music and tear out the crosses and wipe out the pews and put in chairs and everything, I mean, at some point, and people are opposing the pastor, at some point, the pastor has to say, this is the wrong thing, and this isn't from God, and I need to abandon it. But he's too embarrassed to admit to the congregation that he wasted $20,000 or $40,000, and so he continues on with it. Now he's accountable. Now he knows that I'm doing the wrong thing, but I don't care. I'm going to still pursue it and keep going. And that's unfortunately just the way this tends to go. There is hope. Approximately 10% of the churches that enter the TNET process drop out at some point during the process for issues not related to TNET. That's right. This is the issue that's not related to TNET that brings churches out of this. The churches that stick to the Bible, get them out of it, that's not related to TNET.
An incredible experience today. I actually had to run some errands, listen to Rick Warren's The Purpose-Driven Church. Got so excited about it, I immediately got on the cell phone, called my wife. I said, honey, got to come to the office, pick up these tapes, and listen to them right away. I went down to the guy who runs our resource department, said, you got to listen to The Purpose-Driven Church. Went to our CEO. You got to listen to The Purpose-Driven Church. Started handing these things out like hotcakes. And I actually felt a little embarrassed that I'd never taken the time to listen to this audio series. But I can tell you something. The principles are biblical. They're dynamic. And they'll not only revolutionize your church if applied, they'll revolutionize your life as an individual. Maybe a side bonus, you can take the same principles and apply them to your business,
sure,
to your family life. But the purpose-driven church is something that has really captured my imagination. Mm. I can tell you once again, the principles are biblically based. They're sound and revolutionary. You ought to get the purpose-driven church. You'll have the same kind of exhilarating experience that I had today. It's available.
That's Hank Hanegraaff. I don't know if you know who he is, the Bible answer man, supposedly. He's got the wrong answer on this one, folks. He has some other wrong answers, too. He used ministry funds to purchase a $66,000 Lexus for personal use. He bought himself $8,000 in home office flooring, $3,100 in country club dues, which was only 2 months' worth, $3,000 for personal expenses for Mrs. Hanegraaff, and $1,200 for computer repairs for his kids. When the powers that be at CRI found out that this woman had collected more than 20 internal documents to illustrate these problems, she was fired. So she contacted the ECFA. The ECFA demanded and agreed that Hannah Graf would sell the Lexus and that an internal accountability board would be established. However, the leader of that board was fired a month later. He then, since then, he's moved his ministry from Southern California to North Carolina.
What year were you with me in the studio for Focus on the Family?
Oh, boy.
Come on.
I'm going to guess 1985, 84, something
not
like
bad.
That.
Not bad, 87.
87.
All right,
okay.
And what did we talk about? What was the title for that program?
I don't know, but I know that's where I met Bill Hybels.
Yeah, he was here that
yeah,
day.
Facilitated the meeting between Rick Warren and Bill Hybels.
Unbelievably, you have about 16,000 in attendance every Sunday, 50,000 names on your list.
Yeah.
You have a book that we're going to talk about that's the number two best-selling book on the New York Times list now. You have, my goodness, it just goes on and on, Rick. How do you...
Just goes on and on, and all Dobson cares about is the numbers. How many numbers, how many dollars, how many books... That's all he cares about. Publishers that are involved, Zondervan, Jossie Bass, Gospel Light, Nav Press, Christianity Today, Group Publishing, David Cook, and Franklin Covey, all supporting this type of material. An excellent book about youth ministry is called Spiritual Junk Food. This book is an excellent thing as to how this process has infiltrated many of the activities that the youth groups are doing in churches. Bible talks about youthful leadership because the... Leadership Network has a group called the Young Leader Network. Well, youthful leadership is not a good thing. In fact, Isaiah chapter 3 says, "Behold, the Lord of hosts, takes away from Jerusalem and from Judah the stay and the staff, the whole stay of bread and the whole stay of water, and I will give children to be their princes, and babes shall rule over them, and the people shall be oppressed, every one by another and every one by his neighbor. The child shall behave himself proudly against the ancient and the base against the honorable." So youthful leadership is a curse, but Leadership Network has Young Leader Network. They connect Christian leaders who have moved beyond roles and gender, resourcers who can begin giving handholds to emerging leaders who simply want to do something with God in their community, and theologians who construct new theologies that emerge out of practice. So rather than the Word of God being where your theology comes from, it's theology that comes out of practice. They say at Young Leader Networks, we want to bring the best thinkers and practitioners together in settings where ideas and thoughts inform our practice of Christianity in local places. We need your help to move to this new age of ministry built upon various experiences and expressions. Again, it's not built on doctrine. It's built on experience and expression, and they are calling it New Age. Our vision is to contextualize our message by narrative preaching rather than propositional within the framework of relationship. Again, relationship is the key here. Church growth is all based upon relationship, and everything comes underneath that umbrella, which again is turned upside down. The Word of God says, you get your relationship with me right, and then you will have appropriate relationships with people as the secondary result of that. Again, Alpha Course talks about sharing the gospel within the framework of relationship. Again, relationship is king, then the gospel is secondary. Young Leaders Networks, they prefer the mediums of art, expression, and experience, opposed to a boring 95-point sermon used by generations before us to communicate truth. We're not interested in truth. We want something exciting. Well, the mission of Leadership Network is to accelerate the emergence of the 21st century church, as well as the equipping of a new type of 21st century church leader, both church and laity. Again, these people have to be conditioned for this new type of church. They want to focus on leaders who are lifelong learners and who are in positions of influence and can affect a wider distribution of change. This 21st century church paradigm is not centered in theology, but rather focused on structure, organization, and the transition from institutionally based church to a mission-driven church. Again, it's based on the dialectic structure. They said they rolled up their sleeves and they began the task of breaking down the old paradigms of ministry, We have decided how to approach ministering in our present postmodern transition. Now it's time to construct the church of the future. Again, it's based on the Hegelian dialectic and the repeated practice of it, also known as the diaprox. Where is this new way of thinking leading the new church of the future? It's going to be manipulating the church into globalism. Just like I said about the abortion debate, that if they told the Supreme Court originally where they were going to take it to, then they would have never got on it in the first place. And it's similarly, I believe, that the Christian church, if they actually told them what the end play was going to be, that the Christian church wouldn't have fallen for this either. But unfortunately, people haven't been looking down towards the future. Interesting statement, not only for when it was stated, but for who said it. It says, the state must socialize every group. Men must learn to have world patriotism. World patriotism must be a faith. There is no more justice for the claim of absolute sovereignty on the part of a nation than on the part of an individual. The only alternative is world federation with a world parliament, an international court, and an international police force. Men must have an international mind before there can be a world federation. They must see and affirm that above the nation is humanity. Internationalism must first be a religion before it can be a reality and a system. This is written by Samuel Zane Batten in the New World Order, published by the American Baptist Publication Society in 1919. A lot of this is taking place now. We're seeing it. Well, it's a spiritual battle, folks. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Prophecies from the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation talk about the end of the world, the end of the age, with a one-world leader and one-world religious leader and a one-world government ruled by the Antichrist. Rick Warren doesn't want you to learn about prophecy, though. He says, when the disciples wanted to talk about prophecy, Jesus quickly switched the conversation to evangelism. He said, in essence, the details of my return are none of your business. What is your business is the mission I've given you. Focus on that. Well, he didn't read Matthew 24, starting with verse 3. As he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came in to him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. And then later on he said, and many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. So Rick Warren doesn't want to teach prophecy, and he won't teach prophecy because it's going to talk about people like him. Again, on the small scale, this diaprox leads to group harmony. On the large scale, it leads to religious and world harmony. How will we get to this state of flexibility where countries willingly give up their sovereignty and where churches become flexible enough to respond correctly to the new ecumenical reality? Through the diaprox, obviously. Leadership Network says their vision is that the church will be effective in the transformation of individual lives, communities, and the world. This is called smart growth or sustainable development. They're talking about population centers where they want people in highly densely populated areas. They want to leave the majority of the land free for the birds and trees and rocks. And they want to have transportation corridors between these densely populated areas with mass transit, and then areas where you can walk to your needs once you're home. And so they talk about this Paseo Colorado project, which has now been built in Pasadena. That includes a multiplex movie theater, 400 upscale apartments and lofts, shops and restaurants, and a Gelson's Market as an example of all good planning. In other words, once you're home, you don't have to park, you don't have to drive your car anymore. You can just walk to all of your needs. Well, the UN Agenda 21 summary talks about population and the control of that. This is basically a repackagement of the Humanist Manifesto, which is the same principles. They're also going to promote family planning, abortion, and homosexuality because all of these help lead to population control. Environmental, again, they want the corridors and the transportation, mass transit between the population centers, and they want community centers, and that's where the church is going to come into this. Food, shelter, equity, they want health and wealth equity and gender equity. They believe that there are national and religious allegiances, which are philosophical differences that lead to wars. They want to abolish then nationalism. They want to have religious tolerance, diversity, and an ecumenical movement, again, to eliminate wars. The Global Biodiversity Assessment out of the United Nations says on converting to a religious belief system that rejects assignment of sacred qualities to elements of nature, they began to cut down the sacred groves to bring the land under cultivation as well as to market rattan and timber. This led to serious difficulties. Many of these people have therefore reestablished the sacred groves, although now they are termed safety forests instead. And this is, these are the types of areas that are being set aside nowadays with your land. The foundations are buying the land. I'm forgetting the exact term now, but they're setting it aside for no further development. The environmental movement does have a spiritual component with it, with three main enemies: the monotheistic religions, Orthodox Judaism, fundamental Islam, and fundamental Christianity. Currently, we're seeing a war on fundamental Islam. It won't be long before there are wars on fundamental Christianity and on Judaism. The Bible talks about all the world's coming against Israel someday. So these things are coming down the line. The Lucius Trust, which was formed as the Lucifer Trust in the 1920s, talks about a Shambhala force. It says the Shambhala force's impact during the past few years, human thinking has been more concerned with the production of unity and the attainment of synthesis in all human relations than ever before, and one result of this energy has been the formation of the United Nations. So they say the United Nations is a satanic force. Shambhala. 2,000 years have gone since Gethsemane and since Christ made his initial contact with the Shambhala force. It should be carefully borne in mind that evil is much closer to Shambhala than it is to humanity. There are evil forces out there. Shambhala is the energy which brings about synthesis, which holds all things within the circle of the divine love. It has two effects or qualities. The first is the destruction of anything that's hindering in the present world forms, government, religion, and society. So we must destroy anybody that doesn't go with the flow. And we must synthesize those and bind together that which has previously been separated. In other words, get your religions together. Since the Shambhala force's impact, then, human thinking has been more concerned with the... Oh, we already talked about that one. I'm sorry. And the worldwide activities of the Lucius Trust, founded by Alice and Foster Bailey, two Satanists, are dedicated to the establishment of right human relations, and that's called the Divine Project. It's not from God. They say that synthesis dictates the trends of all the evolutionary processes today. All is working towards larger unified blocks, amalgamations, international relationships, global planning, brotherhood, economic fusion, the free flow of commodities everywhere, interdependence, fellowship of faiths, movements based upon the welfare of humanity as a whole, and ideological concepts which deal with wholes and which militate, okay? We get military here against division, separation, and isolation. There will be force coming against groups such as Christians who refuse to go with the flow and get involved in the ecumenical movement. Again, purpose-driven life says relationships must have priority in your life above everything else. They are trying to get you into the flow and saying that for unity's sake, we must never let differences divide us. And that God is clear that we're to confront those who cause division among Christians. We addressed that earlier. George Bush called religious leaders agents of change. And he said, I hope this country is on the verge of a religious revival of all faiths. He said that in February of 2001. That's about 7 months later, on September 11th, there was a religious revival in our country. It was called 9/11. Well, Rick Warren talks about healthy churches. The key issue for churches in the 21st century is church health, not church growth. He says, we get a lot of unhealthy people in our church because society is getting sicker, but Jesus demonstrated that ministering to hurting people was more important than maintaining purity. When you fish with a big net, you get all kinds of fish. So one minute he's saying it's important to have church health, then he says he has a lot of unhealthy people in his church. But it all depends on your definition of health. And health includes mental hygiene, which is the definition based on the United Nations and the World Health Organization. G. Brock Chisholm, the first head of the World Federation of Mental Health and the eventual head of the World Health Organization, said the only psychological force capable of producing perversions is morality, the concept of right and wrong. So to have a concept of right and wrong is to be perverted. And the reinterpretation and eventual eradication of the concept of right and wrong are the belated objectives of nearly all psychotherapy. This small group consensus process is psychotherapy. And the whole goal of it is to wipe out your concept of right and wrong. Bottom line. It all fits. They talk about healthy start, healthy people, healthy kids, healthy families, healthy cities, and healthy communities. Now they're starting to talk about healthy churches. This is becoming a healthy church. Rick Warren says, a wonderful tool I recommend to every church serious about being purpose-driven. This author, it's also recommended by Warren, Hybels, Bill Bright, Jack Hayford, Leonard Sweet. And they say that we may have a personal faith, but we can't have an individual faith. We can't be Christians by ourselves. We have to do it in group. Search Institute talks about then healthy communities and healthy youth, prescription for a healthy church. All kids are our kids. And beyond the village rhetoric, creating healthy communities for children and adolescents. We're going beyond the rhetoric, and we're actually going to implement Hillary's Village here. Mental health, then, is sustainable thought patterns. In other words, you don't have those philosophical differences which can lead to war. You cannot hold true to the statement that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by him. If you hold to that truth, that's a philosophical difference that leads to war. We must eliminate that type of thinking from our society. Warren Bennis dreamed of a university that would teach students how to end all war, diminish pollution, and banish racism. And now he's being quoted by Eric Ries in the Seven Principles of Transformational Leadership out of Saddleback Church. Bennis also talked about the family. And he says, any intervention between parent and child produces familial democracy regardless of its intent. He says, in order to effect a rapid change, one must mount a vigorous attack on the family lest the traditions of present generations be preserved. Is Rick Warren telling you that when they're quoting Warren Bennis? And that it's necessary, in other words, artificially to create an experiential chasm between parents and children. He wrote this in the early 60s. They created the generation gap in the late 60s. G. Brock Chisholm says the people who have been taught to believe whatever they were told by their parents or their teachers are the people who are a menace to the world. That's a Harvard psychologist. He says every child in America entering school at the age of 5 is mentally ill. That is why they're trying to do these new parenting programs and getting the kids into the programs right as soon as they're born. They don't want them to start school at 5 because they have allegiances to their family, allegiances to their faith, that then they have to try to undo because they're pretty well ingrained by the age of 5. So now they're doing all this preschool learning stuff and prepared to go to school and all of those programs so that they can get to your children earlier and wipe out their allegiances to you and their allegiances to God. See, B. Chester Pierce says, because he comes to school with certain allegiances to our founding fathers, towards our elective officials, towards his parents, towards a belief in a supernatural being, and towards the sovereignty of this nation as a separate entity. We don't want our children to have that. It's up to you as teachers to make all of these sick children well by creating the international child of the future. Well, TNet International says accountability serves as a catalyst to obedience. Philosophical purity must be maintained at the leadership level. They say you can't make disciples without accountability. You can't develop a helpful accountability system without a structure. This is the role of church leaders. This is creating healthy Christians. This is how we do it. This is the brainwashing techniques. Willow Creek, pastor and imam, this is a Muslim cleric, had a dialogue after September 11th at Bill Hybels Church. And Bill Hybels said there are some Americans and some Christians spreading rumors and half-truths that the Quran encourages violence. Well, you take some stuff out of context and we've got major problems. And one of the churchgoers said after the service, I didn't know they believed in Jesus. See, that's what happens. You mold it all together and then people walk out confused and they think, oh, gee, Muslims aren't so bad. They believe Jesus existed too. They just don't believe he's God.
I think Islam is misunderstood, too, because Muhammad had a great respect for Jesus, and he called Jesus the greatest of the prophets except himself. And I think that we're closer to Islam than we really think we are.
Respect for Jesus, that would be like me saying that I have a great respect for Jesus, and I called him the greatest of the prophets except for me. That's trampling the Son of Man underfoot as far as I'm concerned. That's not a great respect for Jesus, and Billy is out of his mind. Washington Times say that President Bush met with 27 interfaith clergy, and they got urging patience and justice in America's response to terrorism, and they signed a finalized consensus statement. People involved in that were Franklin Graham, Luis Palau, Gordon Hinckley, the president of the Mormon Church, Charles Blake, who Pastor John showed you earlier today, Max Lucado, James Merritt, the president of Southern Baptist Convention, T.D. Jakes, Bill Hybels, Catholics, Hindus, Buddhists, etc. We're not supposed to be signing consensus statements with non-believers. It's crazy. Contributors to this book, A Spiritual Response to the Attack on America, were T.D. Jakes, Chuck Colson, Max Lucado, Billy Graham, Wilkinson, Rick Warren, Richard Land, the Bishop Cardinal Law, Bill Hybels, Pope John II, His Holiness the Dalai Lama, and Starhawk, who is a witch. In that book, Neil Donald Walsh, a New Ager, made this statement, which none of the so-called Christian leaders contradicted. He said, "We must create a different reality, build a new society. We must do so with new spiritual truths. We must preach a new gospel summarized. We are all one. Ours is not a better way. Ours is merely another way." None of the so-called Christian leaders quoted in that book contradicted this statement. But Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." We don't have a new gospel that we're all one and we're all together. No, there's only one true way to heaven. "And though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you other than that which is preached unto you, let him be accursed." Neil Donald Walsh, by that statement alone, is accursed. This is Stephen Rockefeller at the Gorbachev State of the World Forum. He says, "This new ecological age of developing global community and interfaith dialogue, the world religions face what is perhaps the greatest challenge that they've ever encountered. Each is inspired by a unique vision of the divine and has a distinct cultural entity. At the same time, each perceives the divine as the source of unity and peace. The challenge is to preserve their religious and cultural uniqueness without letting it operate as a cause of narrow and divisive sectarianism that contradicts the vision of divine unity and peace." You can have your Christianity as long as it doesn't contradict this greater issue of divine unity and peace among all men. Peace on earth, goodwill towards men, is above the gospel. It's a question of whether the healing light of religious vision will overcome the social and ideological issues that underlie much of the conflict between religions, Rockefeller says. Robert Schuller, in My Journey, says, "I'm dreaming a bold, impossible dream that positive thinking believers in God will rise above the illusions that our sectarian religions have imposed on the world, and that leaders of the major faiths will rise above doctrinal idiosyncrasies, choosing not to focus on disagreements, but rather to transcend divisive dogmas, to work together to bring peace and prosperity and hope to the world." Church of Small Groups said, "They've made our church one where we could lead together towards a common vision of an ever more inclusive community." That's not the way the Bible works. The Bible says that narrow is the way. Straight is the path. Pastors.com, they talked about a screening of the Passion of the Christ, and they obviously didn't get it. They said, "For the first time, if Jesus himself had walked on the stage at the end of the movie," this is what they said, "I think for the first time ever you would have Catholics, Baptists, Methodists, Episcopalians, and non-denominationalists all responding the exact same way. No arguments, no disputes, no disagreements. Every pastor, every priest, every church leader or elder would have all responded in exactly the same way. All of us 4,400 ministers would have bowed down and gone to our knees in awe of the incredible price that had been paid for each one of us." No, that's not what would have happened there. Jesus would have come on the scene and said, "Goats to the left, sheep to the right. Sorry, your Catholic priests, your female pastors aren't all going to be bowing before me. They're going to be sent somewhere." And it's not going to be unity. But they said this is the power of the Passion of the Christ, was to bring everybody together. And that's what Pastors.com, Rick Warren's website, stated. Church of Small Group, again, "We must run persistently against all that destroys community, divisiveness, fear, pride, and self-interest." Jesus said, "I think not that I have come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword." The Leadership Institute of Robert Schuller has involved Bill Hybels, H.B. London Jr. from Focus on the Family, John Maxwell, Charles Blake, etc. Here he is with Lee Strobel, an assistant pastor at Rick Warren's church, who used to be an assistant pastor at Willow Creek. Here's Schuller back in the early days with Billy Graham. And Schuller actually talks about how Billy Graham funded Schuller's ministry to come on television originally.
Tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity?
Well, Christianity and being a true believer, you know, I think there's the body of Christ, which comes from all the Christian groups around the world, or outside the Christian groups. I think everybody that loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And I don't think that we're going to see a great sweeping revival that will turn the whole world to Christ at any time. I think James answered that, the Apostle James, in the first council in Jerusalem, when he said that God's purpose for this age is to call out a people for his name. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
This is fantastic. And I'm so thrilled to hear you say that. There's a wideness in God's mercy.
There is. There definitely is.
Well, it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You need to know the name of the Lord. And straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leads to life, and few there be that find it. There's not this wideness that everybody's going to be in heaven together. The United Nations talks about civil society. So does Focus on the Family. They talk about promoting healthy families, vibrant churches, and a civil society. I like this statement by Clarence Thomas. He said, by trying to be tolerant and non-judgmental, that is, we censor ourselves. This is not civility. It is cowardice or well-intentioned self-deception at best. So this whole civil society means you're a complete coward. Schuller meets with Gorbachev. He says, you claim to be an atheist, but I don't believe you. You're not an atheist. You keep referring with such respect and affection to Jesus Christ, and anyone who respects Jesus Christ cannot call himself an atheist.
To say anywhere in public that I am a communist and believe in the socialist idea. I will die believing this and pass into the next world believing this.
At the Gorbachev State of the World Forum in 2000, this invitation went out. God is love, and you are invited to join in daily meditation with all the symbols of Christianity, Judaism, Islam, Buddhism, Hindu, all kinds of stuff. But again, we're not to have communion of light with darkness.
Give me an idea, give the listeners a good idea, a thumbnail sketch, if you will, what the mission of the Gorbachev Foundation is, what its function is, what Gorbachev and what you hope to accomplish as a charter.
Our charter is a very simple one. We believe that Mr. Gorbachev is a powerful figure in modern history and in the 20th century, and we believe that he has an extraordinary power to convene as a senior statesman, and we believe that right now the human race is giving birth to the first global civilization, and so we're working with him to help shape that in the first instance by calling together the most thoughtful and innovative individuals that we can find quite literally around the world, to gather together and form a global brain trust that will look at what principles and values and actions should shape the next phase of human development. So that's very simply put what our mission is, how we originally...
So the goal of the Gorbachev Foundation is to get together all of the great thinkers in the world who are going to shape the next stage of human evolution and yet Shuler thinks Gorbachev's a Christian. Stephen Covey, you've probably heard of his Seven Habits book. He is the one who actually engineered the Gorbachev State of the World Forum in 2000. And the author of Becoming a Healthy Church refers to his use of Stephen Covey's Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. He's another transformational Marxist, and Christians shouldn't be using his book. Earth Charter is founded by Gorbachev as well.
That capitalism is not necessarily compulsory
in a
Christian society.
Not at all. It's I've been to all the socialist countries, especially the communist-dominated countries in the world, and somehow we, and I explain in the book how we managed to get into those countries and how we managed to be received by the government and how they backed us in our meetings before the wall ever came down. And I was received in nearly all the communist countries, including the Russia and the Soviet Union. And people were amazed, and they wondered how that could happen.
He says that communism is not inconsistent with Christianity. Communism is based on atheism. And yet he was welcomed with open arms into these communist countries, as was Rick Warren into China as well, because their form of Christianity is no threat to communism. True biblical Christianity is communism's worst enemy. Church Champions from Leadership Network talks about, let's hear it for the deviants, and they recommend comrades, brothers, fathers, heroes, sons, and pals. So now they're starting to talk in terms of comrades. And they say, comrades is a story of male friendships, but I'm happy to comment that one of my comrades and friends here at Leadership Network celebrated her 6th anniversary on our team. Humanism, we talked again about the whole goal of humanism, and I've got all of these things listed here, that they deny creationism, they embrace evolution, etc. Basically, what the whole humanist thing is, they think that man's basically good. They think that man can solve all the problems of the world. They can solve hunger, they can solve crime, they can solve wars, and because of man's inherent good nature, and that eventually they're going to, through this process of evolution, create heaven on earth apart from God. That's the bottom line. And so that's what humanism is all based on. The world, according to Peter Drucker, he's best known for his humanistic approach to business management, the provost of his graduate university says. So he's a humanist. He claims to be an Episcopalian. He claims to be a Christian, but then he doesn't talk about faith. He talks about pluralism and diversity and humanism. They say that we believe in keeping with the Drucker philosophy that management is very much a human enterprise. So he's a humanist, bottom line. This is what Rick Warren based his church on, is the thinkings and the thoughts of
Ferdinand Drucker.
For his contributions as the father of modern management, he recently received the Medal of Freedom, the highest honor bestowed by the White House.
Peter Drucker's prolific writings have greatly benefited our nation and significantly influenced the shape of our society and the modern business world. The United States honors his extraordinary accomplishments.
As Columbus discovered America, Drucker discovered management. Professional managers had long been in charge of America's corporations, but little had been written about them until Drucker arrived on the American business scene in the 1940s.
So he's a transformational Marxist who's destroying our freedoms in our country, and yet he gets the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Well, Drucker says the nonprofit sector is where management today is needed most needed, and where systematic, principled, theory-based management can yield the greatest results fastest. In other words, nonprofit. That's talking about your church. Think of the enormous problems facing the world. Poverty, healthcare, education, international tension, and the need for managed solutions becomes loud and clear. Well, this is Rick Warren's plan, the Global Peace Plan. It's the exact same thing. He's talking about spiritual lostness, although Rick himself is spiritually lost. He's talking about lack of godly leaders, although he is not a godly leader. He's talking about curing poverty, disease, and lack of education, the same humanistic goals that Peter Drucker is talking about. He wants to get every small group involved, and he's talking about tens of thousands of small groups being involved and with these globalist implications. And again, you've signed up to be a member of a small group. Now you're signing up to actually implement the globalist plan.
That is what globalization means. It is not an economic event, it's a psychological phenomenon.
Group psychology. Church Champions talks about systematic approaches to reinstating growth in plateaued churches. It's probably the best written work of Senge systems theory applied to churches. Systems thinking was presented at, again, the Gorbachev State of the World Forum 2000. Peter Drucker and Senge have written books together. Here they are together. Senge has also performed leadership network conferences called Exploring Off the Map. Basically, what exploring off the map is, thinking outside the box, breaking through the barriers. This is the box. This is the map. This is the barriers to all of our things. And so anytime you're talking about thinking outside the box, it's saying, how can we defy God? How can we get outside his boundaries that are set for us? Exploring off the map, going outside the boundaries. It's all the same thing. Senge is also involved in the Shambhala Institute. Remember that Shambhala devilish force that Jesus met in the Garden of Gethsemane? Well, there are also this group called Shambhala Institute, which joins collaborative learning and meditative insight. They bring Buddhism along with meditation and organizational or total quality management type disciplines. It's inspired by this Chogram Trungpa Rinpoche, who claims to be a tulku, is a previously enlightened teacher. So in other words, he was a teacher in a previous life. And Senge is involved with this. He's also taught systems theory to the Club of Rome, and he helped collaboration with this book, The Limits to Growth. This book is basically like Al Gore's book, Earth in the Balance. It's basically saying that there's not enough resources here, we're overpopulated, we need to wipe out some of the human population and control the population so that the world can go on. And this systems approach is a way of looking at the world and ourselves, and it owes much to Gestalt psychology, says Peter Drucker. And Gestalt, again, is transformational Marxism. Age of Heretics is a book that Senge agrees with. It's a book that documents all of these transformational Marxists and how they came into the U.S. and the national training laboratories and everything. It's a good book as a research book. It's interesting that they call them heretics. They're saying they're heretics because they were ahead of their time and that they were their heretics of the day, but actually they're really just, they were heretics. Spiritual gifts assessments now. We were talking about, they talk about organizers, people who like to create order out of chaos. Well, Masons like to create order out of chaos. That's what at the bottom of this, it says Ordo Ab Chao. This is the 33rd symbol of the 33rd degree of Freemasonry. They want to create chaos so that then they can take control. Robert Schuller, Norman Vincent Peale, and Billy Graham all have ties to the Masons. Here's Norman Vincent Peale along with the Schuller family.
You knew Fulton Sheen. You knew Norman Peale. Your comments on both of these men.
I think that the primary way of communicating is to live the life. Let people see that you're living what you proclaim. And I think both of them lived it. And I knew both of them as you did and loved them both.
Friend of Billy Graham's, a 33rd degree Mason. These missions organizations, especially Campus Crusade for Christ, Habitat for Humanity, and Prison Fellowship International, as well as the Southern Baptist Convention and World Vision and Salvation Army, have been listed on the United Nations Department of Public Information website. The DPI is a group that you have to apply for this status, and you have to agree with the goals and the charter of the United Nations. You have to have a large membership. You have to have a large ability to reach your membership with mailings and other communications. You have to give pro-United Nations materials out to your people, and you have to feed back to the United Nations on a regular basis the fact that you're doing so in order to remain on that list. So none of these people, Southern Baptist Convention included, which of course Rick Warren is part of, have been listed on that Department of Public Information promoting the United Nations activities. World Vision, founded by Ted Engstrom on the board of directors of Focus on the Family for 19 years as well, close friends with Zondervan Publishers, who published Rick Warren's books, former president of Youth for Christ. He is well known in Christian and management circles. And also the World Vision has another offshoot from it called the Evangelical Environmental Network. The EEN is a member of the Interfaith Partnership for the Environment. They're listed in Earth and Faith, a book of reflection for action published by the Interfaith Partnership for the Environment and the United Nations Environmental Program. And they were represented at the Gorbachev State of the World Forum back in 2000. This is that book. They recommend that you, in words and prayer and action, that you celebrate the earth, that you organize an interfaith ceremony, you organize cleanup days and tree planting ceremonies, you invite guest speakers and representatives of other species from algae to animals to come and address your congregation. So bring a rock and have them talk to your congregation. And then sure enough, APU, where he was the interim president, took out the freshman students, and the first thing they did was pick up trash and plant trees. That's what you do in theology school nowadays. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, into birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Here's Engstrom along with Peter Drucker at one of the Christian Management Association meetings. And here he is. He was tied with Billy Graham back in the early days along with Youth for Christ. Josie Bass is a publisher that publishes many of these materials, a vision retreat, a facilitator's guide, the Change Agents series for group and organizations, training and human resource manuals, and they publish The Tao at Work. And they are also publishing, they're in partnership with the Leadership Network and publishing many so-called Christian works. After church growth, what then? The next movement will grow partnerships. Partnerships, alliances, and collaboration will become the norm, and these future relationships will be built on new loyalties and a new common mission. This is the Leadership Network in 1995. It's all about sustainable development and the United Nations Agenda 21. Their role in the 21st century, the United Nations, is freedom from fear, again, peace and no war, globalization and governance, sustaining our planet for future generations, freedom from want, and renewing the United Nations, because of course, if once we achieve all of these goals, we can't just eliminate the United Nations, they still must sustain themselves. Again, the summary is overpopulation, environment, food and shelter, health and wealth inequity, gender inequity, misguided nationalism, and elimination of the philosophical or religious differences which lead to wars. This is a repackagement of the Humanist Manifesto. We talked about this. And they say, how is this going to happen? Group initiation, this is out of satanic literature. Group initiation means that the bulk of the members are correctly oriented, that they are proposing to accept the discipline which will prepare them for the next great expansion of consciousness, and that none of them can possibly be deviated from their purpose. And interesting, it says, note that word with its first ray or shambolic implications. So purpose has a special meaning to the Satanist. Purpose-driven life. No matter what is happening in the environment or their personal life, you need to reflect on this if you desire to make the needed progress. The clue to all this esoteric work demanded by Shambhala is to be found in the development of the art of visualization. This is your visioning and your mission statements. Through visualization, three expressions of the human consciousness will become possible. Groups, large wholes, and major syntheses will be visualized, and this will lead to a definite expansion of consciousness. Thus, the sense of synthesis will be unfolded. So all of these groups, our countries, need to synthesize together, the religions need to synthesize together, and then we will expand our consciousness. And the unfoldment of the sense of vision and the sense of synthesis through visualization will lead to a sense of livingness in form. Peter Senge again, Deepak Chopra, and Neil Donald Walsh, New Agers, have imagined what America could be in the 21st century. It's all about imagining, visioning. But we're to take no thought for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself, sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. TNET says we're committed to multiplication of our training network through partnerships with denominations, networks, and mission organizations throughout the globe. Well, Jürgen Habermas, a transformational Marxist, is the person who developed the theory of networks in the 1960s. Leadership Network says the next movement will grow partnerships, not properties. Partnerships, alliances, and collaboration will become the norm rather than the exception. These future relationships will be built on new loyalties and a new common mission. Emergent Partnerships, New Ways in a New World, again by Peter F. Drucker, sponsored by the Rockefeller Brothers Fund and Mutual of America Life Insurance Company. They talk about public-private partnerships, that's called fascism, and public nonprofit partnerships, which is when your church is partnering with the government, those are the faith-based partnerships, which President Bush is supporting.
1982, you got involved in peace with your trip to Russia, and you said that you really had had three conversions in your life. The first one with Christ. The second, your determination to work for racial justice, and starting with the rallies in the South and so on. And then the third, your commitment to work for world peace. I mean, those were the three stages, were they?
They were, but there's another one, and that is for the social betterment of people. For example, to help the homeless and the hungry and the starving and the people that have been in disaster areas. And we have set up an entire organization that is run by our organization to do that sort of thing. And we raise millions of dollars each year to help in those type of areas, like in Rwanda or Zaire at the moment, and so forth.
Noble causes to work for, you know, the elimination of hunger and people, you know, give shelter after a hurricane and things like that. But it's not to be our primary focus. And again, our focus isn't to be the world or humanism, but our focus is to be on Christ. Certainly, feeding somebody that's hungry, I'm not going to deny, is a noble thing to do. But the issue is when that becomes the first priority rather than making sure that they're fed spiritually. These partnerships with the government, Clinton had it, the education partner with the church. But there's a couple of rules when you take this money for the church. They have to ensure that all activities and programs provided by the groups are purely secular. They had to select student participants without regard to their religion. And they had to tell volunteers not to pray with students or preach about faith. They recommended that schools put a partnership agreement in writing and make sure that any space used for teaching was free of religious symbols. Remember, they cleared out the church to bring in the unbelievers, and they got rid of all the religious symbols so that the people would not be intimidated when they came into the congregation, because they wanted it not to look like a church. But what they're really doing is they're bringing themselves into compliance with the government funding. Again, Bush recommending funding these armies of compassion. And interestingly, he was then rewarded in the last election. This article actually makes the argument that Bush was reelected because of the fact that he gave so much money to inner city black churches through their faith-based partnerships that they reciprocated and made sure that their normally liberal voting membership delivered back to the president and voted him back into office thanks to the money from the government. Interesting concept. Well, Bob Buford in Halftime says many churches are adding volunteer resource directors or linking teams. In Dallas, the Park City's Presbyterian Church launched a linking program which has developed more than 2,500 different placement opportunities for service. This is where the pastor is taking your abilities and your jobs and the other hobbies that you have, and then he's placing you into community service because he's the CEO telling you where you're going to serve. You're not necessarily serving the church, now you're serving the community. Well, the satanic literature says the Christ will be known by the work he does, by the world influence he wields, and by his ability to work with and through every individual and every group who have trained themselves for world service. So these people in these churches are being trained for world service. It's one-stop shopping. Buford talks about the 21st century church reforming itself into a multifaceted service operation. We talked about these densely populated areas and having everything that you need within walking distance. The government, in order to accomplish this, needs buildings and infrastructure close to neighborhoods in areas that are walking distance from people's houses. So if they get the church involved, they've got buildings and infrastructure that are already there, they fund the faith-based services, and then you have your needs met within walking distance of your home. The community needs a community center, Peter Drucker says. I'm not talking religion now, I'm talking society. There's no other institution in the American community that could be the center. He's talking about churches. Okay, so churches are no longer for the perfecting of the saints and the edification of the body of Christ. They're now just another way that the government can meet the needs of the people in the community. The churches have completely changed and become completely secular. Leadership Network says that Windsor Village United Methodist Church in Texas has several nonprofit entities related to housing, job training and employment, medical and dental services, and educational ventures. Willow Creek is in partnership with World Vision to recreate Vision Chicago in an effort to link Willow Creek with urban ministries. Summerhill Neighborhood Incorporated in Atlanta was founded by a partnership of churches to revitalize Summerhill into a vibrant, growing, and self-sustaining community and has established a medical center, low-cost clothing store, daycare center, and housing rehab program. They even use the word self-sustaining community, sustainable development. This is Agenda 21, straight out of the United Nations. It's smart growth, and your church is in it. So, bottom line is then, the environment needs community centers so that you can be in your densely populated area within walking distance. Food, shelter, health, and wealth equity. And these churches are claiming this is the first century church model where everybody had things in common and that it was a socialistic system. That wasn't the case. Dioprox is leading to national and religious tolerance, and it's putting now aside your moral absolutes for the sake of the world. The overall shift is from Father God, patriarchal, to matriarchal, Mother Earth, or Gaia. Hierarchical leadership is now decentralized, although that always becomes totalitarian in a crisis. So you can have decentralized leadership, but as soon as the crisis hits, you've got a dictator that takes over and everybody submits. And accountability to God is being shifted to accountability to fellow man and Mother Earth. What then should we do? As watchmen, we've made watchmen unto the house of Israel, therefore hear the word of my mouth and give them warning from me. When I say to the wicked, you shall surely die, and you give him not warning nor speak to warn the wicked from his wicked way to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at your hand. If you warn the wicked and he turn not from his wickedness nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but you have delivered your soul. Again, when a righteous man does turn from his righteousness and commits iniquity, and I lay a stumbling block before him, he shall die. Because you have not given him warning, he shall die in his sin, and his righteousness which he has done will not be remembered, but his blood will I require at thine hand. Nevertheless, if you warn the righteous man that the righteous sin not, and he does not sin, he shall surely live. Because he is warned, you also have delivered your soul. Knowing this information, it is inherently true that we need to go out and disseminate this information and just warn the wicked people. Then when they refuse the warning, their blood's on their own head. And we're also to come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. So we can't stay inside these churches and do this. This is biblical separation. We're to mark those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which we have learned and avoid them. This is the scriptures that involve working within in the church. There are none. Okay? When the church takes on this process and this program, you cannot stay because you're supposed to come out from among them. When people want to stay and try to work from within, the reason that they're doing that most likely is that they've got their human relationships and they don't want to break those human relationships, so they're trying to work from within. They never get anywhere working within, and the bottom line is they either finally leave or they get processed and they go along with it. It's dangerous to do that. That's why we're not told to work from within. It's dangerous to do that. That's why we're told to come out from among it. And the interesting question is, shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him?